Here we go. All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to our prologue session of the forthcoming Blazing Blasters campaign using All Flesh Must Be Eaten. The campaign slated for a couple months from now is called Deep Contagion. This one, however, is called...
No exit.
You guys should all have sight on that.
Mm-hmm.
With us tonight, we have Walter Peck playing Captain Jim Lorenz. We have a newcomer by the name of The Bees playing Sergeant Hank Ellis. We have the Prankster playing Lieutenant Jim Terrence. And we have the lovely Slip playing Dr. Jessica Harry. And without further ado, we're going to go ahead and get started. Introduction. January 1992, somewhere in the mid-Pacific. The sky was red as the sun sank over the dark waters of the Pacific. It was a glowing fireball. An inferno of sparkling orange contrasted against the black spots of crashing waves. It was going to storm tonight. Captain Jim Lorenz, commanding officer of the USS Nordstrom, didn't need a weather scanner to tell him that. He was older than most on board, serving in the Persian Gulf during the war with Saddam before receiving his current command. Being a leader is hard, but the captain had a few old friends on board. He considered himself lucky to serve with two others from the Gulf. Sergeant Hank Ellis was on deck with him looking at the sunset. Ellis was an engineer and technician extraordinaire. The Persian Gulf gave the U.S. a chance to show off its newest tech. Ellis kept it running. Then there was Jim. Jim Terrence was a SEAL assigned to the Nordstrom, and in particular, Lorenz's detail. Word was that Admiralship had Terrence pegged for a future officer and fast-track to OCS. In the meantime, though, Jim was stuck at sea. The three sailors stood on deck as the sun set. In a moment, they would go below decks to meet with the ship physician, Dr. Jessica Perry. As competent as she was beautiful, Perry was set to give a sit rep regarding an SOS she received earlier in the afternoon. Apparently, a U.S. submersible of some sort was in distress. The Nordstrom was the closest vessel, and with the storm approaching, it was tasked with the rescue. Word was that there were multiple sick and injured on board, and Dr. Perry wanted to alert command and get a plan together before making contact later that night. And before flashing back to Dr. Perry's conversation with whoever called out that SOS, we're going to move to the deck of the Nordstrom. As the sun sets, clouds roll in, and you can see sheets of rain off in the distance as they close towards USS Nordstrom. Now I'll let you guys take it away as you're on deck.
So Lieutenant Jim probably kind of makes his way towards the edge, looking in the water, where presumably the submersible is.
Yeah, not there quite
yet. Oh, okay. My bad. So he's on the edge looking out at the sea then, with everyone else. Taking in the sea breeze and looks back at his friends. Do we have any more details on this yet?
Captain Lorenz had been standing stoic with a sour demeanor on his face, a longtime officer in the Navy, staring off into the distance as the storm slowly approaches, knowing that his ship is in for some rough waters. With his hands behind his back, he sees Lieutenant Terrence turn to him and kind of sourly. If there's one thing I don't like, it's going into the unknown. Sadly, we have few details on who we're saving and why they need saving, other than there's some sort of illness on board that requires the attention of a USS carrier.
Sergeant Ellis, seasoned sailor himself, is the engineer, one of the engineers on board. Got some nice wrinkle lines of older age, but great smile. I love this character. He looks so friendly. So he's a nice guy. He's a Midwestern guy, but he's also, he's kind of annoyed. I we don't have enough problems around here. I spent the whole day putting out fires, literally. You know, we had don't have our old problems. We got to take care of somebody else now.
If I didn't think you could handle these problems, you wouldn't be my chief petty officer on board.
I appreciate that, Captain. Well, let's go see the doc, see what she's got to say.
Indeed. I will have, once we get close to the submersible, I will call for a general readiness, and we will secure the passengers and quickly get them to the infirmary so the doctor can assess the situation. But, Lieutenant, have your SEALs be prepared for a quick survey and reconnaissance of the submersible to ensure we're not letting something dangerous on board or contagious.
Yes, sir. And so, yeah, Lieutenant, you know, gives him a salute. After he does that, you can kind of hear him, you know, pulling off his radio, talking about it, giving the commands to his very officers. You see kind of a slight strain in the corner of his temples, anxious from, you know, the unknown.
And as they wrap up on deck, they look out as the sun sinks below the horizon in a bloom of red. The waves get higher and higher. The wind whips up, and as right below, before they go below deck, there's a peal of thunder, and it starts to rain. But a few hours earlier, you guys should be able to see that.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Put you there. 2 hours earlier, we find Dr. Jessica Perry down in the medical ward. She's actually kind of helping one of her physician assistants, a nurse, and a tech restrain a sailor. This sailor just seems very upset. Word is he came from the mess hall, got in a fight with one of the other sailors. He has a pretty bad broken hand and arm. Ah, goddammit, just let me go. It'll be fine. Ah, that motherfucker had it coming to him. Did you hear what he said about my daughter back home? And you're looking at his arm, and it's just like dinner forked. And the PA is like, you're going to have to give this guy something to sedate him, Doc. We're never going to get him on the x-ray table like this.
She gives the sailor a stern look and crosses her arms across her chest. Sailor, you're not leaving this room until I've had a chance to properly examine your arm. Do you need to be sedated, or will you cooperate?
Ah, god damn it. I guess the quicker I cooperate, the quicker I get out of here. What do you think, Doc? Is it broken? He just kind of holds it up to you, and like his wrist is just at a 90 degree angle, basically. And he smells like alcohol for some reason. Probably not supposed to have it, but I don't know what these sailors get up to in their spare time.
Yeah, she gestures for him to, you know, sit in a chair and place your arm as gently as you can on the examination table. I'll take a look at it, but yes, I'm afraid that does look like a break.
Oh, shit. That's going to get me shore duty?
That's not my decision, but I'll write up a report with whatever I find.
I could use some shore duty, Doc. Hey, you put in a good word for me, right? We've been out in the Pacific for far too long. I'm starting to go crazy out here. It's like a desert, but with water.
tensions do seem to be a little high, and storms never make it any easier. And with this, she's kind of taking a look at the break and very gently, you know, manipulating his hand just so that she can see, you know, if the bones punctured the skin, you know, what needs to be readjusted.
Broke through the radius. It's called a Colley's fracture. It's a cell and broke his wrist. It's pretty badly angulated. You look up on the x-ray film. He's clearly going to need a cast and whatnot. So the physician assistant kind of moves to help him get off the x-ray table there. Just, that's better, more likely. You're much more pleasant, sailor, when you cooperate. There is a 1992 style intercom in the medical area. It starts to beep. Dr. Perry?
Just a moment. She kind of gestures to the physician assistant. Start getting him prepped for the cast. We're going to have to set that break, obviously, before that happens. And she walks over to the wall and pushes the intercom button. This is Dr. Perry.
Here, beep. Hey, Doc. Good to hear your voice again. It's been a couple days. Hey, you haven't seen the captain around, have you?
Does she recognize the voice?
Yeah, it's one of the communications officers from the bridge.
She pushes the intercom and says, I've been pretty busy down here. So no, I haven't. Why? What's up?
Okay. Well, we'll put out an all alert for him and get him here too. Hey, would you be able to come up to the bridge? There's something here you got to see.
She kind of looks over her shoulder at the others and she nods. I'll be there in, 5 to 10 minutes.
Roger that. We'll expect you here. We'll try to contact the captain in the meantime.
Okay. She releases the intercom button and she walks back over. Okay, I'm going to set this break before we get out of here, and then I'm going to leave you in the capable hands of my PA and the nurse here. And she thinks about giving him an anesthetic, but knows he's got alcohol in his system, too. Would there be some sort of local she could give him?
I know personally from real life, but give me a medicine roll.
Okay.
It's going to be really easy since you're a doctor, so you're going to get a +2 with it. So skill attribute menu, and then there's going to be something called medicine, I think.
And then you said modifier +2?
Yes.
Okay.
It's very good. That is 4 levels of success. So, yeah, you know what? You could set this thing if you're to lasso. It's going to hurt like hell. Mm-hmm. But you could, with his booze on board, you could give them something called a hematoma block where you inject basically an anesthetic into the area of the break, kind of in that space that's filled with the hematoma from the actual break itself with bleeding. And that typically will numb up the bone at least somewhat so you can get a good set for your bone.
Working quickly, she has the nurse prep that syringe and, you know, kind of talks to the sailor a little bit while she's injecting the hematoma blocker.
Yep. Here you go, nurse. 10 cc's of 0.5% bupivacaine.
And then after a minute, when she thinks maybe it's started to work, she says, all right. This is going to hurt. You're not going to give me any trouble, are you?
No trouble for me. As long as you put a good word in for that shore leave.
All right. Well, she says, okay, on 3. 1, 2, and on 2 she sets the brake.
He kind of yells out. And the brake... The brake is set. It's kind of more lined up now. He's kind of holding his arm. Ah, Doc! You said it wasn't going to hurt. I guess it wasn't as bad as it could have been, but damn!
I think you might have misheard me, sailor. But the worst part's over now. They just need to get you in a cast, all right? I have somewhere I need to be.
Roger that. If I didn't say it before, Doc, thanks a lot.
That's what I'm here for.
Perry might be down in a minute. I think I broke his goddamn jaw.
She looks at the others. All right, do what you can without me. If it's something urgent, let me know. And she takes off her gloves and dumps them in the, you know, the proper waste container and sanitizes her hands and then heads up to the deck, to the wherever the communications officer was.
Bridge.
The bridge.
Yeah. You walk through the narrow hallways of the ship, your shoes click-clacking on the metal grating thereof, and your footsteps ring throughout a narrow stairwell that spirals up into the ship's bridge. As you go up there, the bridge is illumined in a warm red light, interspersed with splashes of blue and greens and other colors of the ship's instruments. It's very dark outside. Only thing you can see is, you know, several yards in front of you and just a rain coming down like sheets of liquid crystal. The comms officer greets you as you kind of come up. Hey, Doc. God, good to see you here. We're arranging for a meeting down in the captain's quarters, but I wanted to make you aware of this as soon as possible. It sounds like we have a distress call coming in. Are they going to need some medical attention? Just received an SOS.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was muted.
She was shocked in this time.
she says,
shocked.
So what does the SOS say? Are they responding to any attempts to reach them?
No, it's just this message is just on a loop over and over. I don't know if their instruments are down, the radio's down, or what. We weren't aware of any other vessels operating in this area, Doc. Sonar hasn't picked up anything either.
Is it military? Scientific?
He's saying he's from the U.S. Department of State. At the end of the message, he does give his ID number and credentialing. It seems to check out. Here, let me play it for you. And he walks over to one of the consoles and hits a button. And you hear a blare of static, and you hear a voice say, SOS! SOS! This is Dr. Jeff Milner, United States, Director of Operations of, and there's static. This is Dr. Jeff Milner, Department of State. We request immediate aid at the following coordinates. He kind of rattles off some coordinates. Our vessel is in distress. We have injured and ill, most minor, some grievously hurt. Please, we request aid. It is of the utmost importance. And just goes on a loop. He rattles off some credentials and ID numbers at the end that apparently do check out. The comms officer says, we're out in the middle of nowhere, Doc. We'll contact the captain, but I think this mission's going to be on us.
Yeah. I wonder if we'd be able to reach anyone that could give us any information on this vessel, but obviously, the captain needs to be informed. He's the one who's going to make the decision. Oh, but thank you. Thank you, yes. A little bit of a heads up to... My mind's already thinking of how we're going to need to prep for this.
Roger that. Let me know if you need anything, Dr. Perry. I know it's been busy down there. Rumor is one of the pilots whipped up a hell of a batch of bathtub gin.
Yes, I'm already seeing some of the fruits of that labor. But you happen to reach this vessel, please let us know right away, particularly size and number of people that we're going to need to take on.
Roger that. We are picking up something on the sonar now. It seems to be 15, 20 kilometers away. Might take a little time with this storm brewing.
All right. You said that you had already summoned the captain or contacted him?
Roger that. We contacted his office assistant. He's combing the ship for him. You know how the captain likes to go out on deck with his buddy, Hank Ellis. I hear there was a nice sunset tonight with clouds and all.
Well, not anymore.
All right. I'll see you soon, Dr. Perry.
She nods. Goes to wait for the captain.
Alright, let me bring them up here. So, some minutes go by, and I'll let you guys kind of role-play yourselves in as you guys all walk into the captain's quarters. There are likely some other officers there, a few sailors and whatnot, as this meeting has been convened. I'll let you kind of role-play how it goes down.
Captain is the first to walk into the situation room. Petty officer calling attention. As he walks in, he takes his hat off and nods to the senior staff before telling them at ease. Sitting at a desk, or sitting at the head of the table desk, whatever's available, he waits for the others to sit before giving a general report of what to expect. He looks to the air boss and says, we're getting into some choppy weather. I want you to make sure all those planes and helicopters are securely fastened. I don't want to lose a single one. That costs the military up to $55 million per plane. I don't want to be hooked with the bill. Neither do you. And he kind of turns to the lieutenant of the Marine detachment and goes, we're on a rescue op, but we're heading in. We have some unknown factors. I want you guys to be on the ready if General Quarters is called. I want this to be handled efficiently and smoothly. Turns to Ellis. I want those engines humming. We're going to need everything we got to get through this stormy weather with the aircraft carrier. I don't want any other surprises. And lastly, he turns to Lieutenant Terrence and goes, and you, when we get to the submersible, I want you to secure it. And then Dr. Perry can come on and assess the situation. Once we get there, we'll decide what MOP level we need to make sure whatever that they're sick from isn't airborne, whatever that contagion is. I don't want you getting it.
Yeah, I really need to be the first person to spot these, to get eyes on anyone who is ill. If there is risk of contagion, I need to know what sort of containment is going to be necessary, quarantine, or, you know, what... I'm worried that if you send your men in before I do, well, they will unintentionally expose themselves to something.
Captain's nose kind of wrinkles as he's not used to having his orders questioned, and he goes, I'm sorry, ma'am, but can you fire a gun? What SEAL training did you complete, may I ask?
I can fire a gun. I have not completed any SEAL training. But exactly how much medical training have you had in your lengthy and distinguished career? Will you be able to recognize Ebola when you see it?
The captain kind of sits there quietly for a moment. I recommend that the lieutenant take his team in with full MOP gear. If you need to go with them, I will allow it. Looks to Jim. The second you see any danger, you need to pull her out.
Thank you, Captain.
Yes, sir.
That does give me some peace of mind.
Once we reach this submersible, we will hail them. I've been informed by the comm officer that their distress is on loop. It's something I don't much care for. But we will assess the situation once we get into their, once we get next to this vessel.
How many empty, what's our current capacity for housing extra passengers and or possibly quarantining? And she'll ask questions like that.
Do we know how many people are on the submersible?
No, we don't.
I'm sure we can have one of the flight decks or one of the decks serve as a temporary casualty reception area.
Triage,
thank you. Casualty collection point. I couldn't remember my military training. It's been a while. If there's casualties or sick, we can assess and then set up a quarantine area there. We will see how long this storm lasts. If it's longer than anticipated, we will keep them below deck. However, once the storm passes, if you believe it to be a serious risk, we will set up a quarantine on the flight deck until we can return to the closest port.
She nods.
Captain, are we receiving any... you said that this is just on a loop, so we're receiving nothing back from them? Any attempts at communication are going unanswered?
All hails have been unheeded as of right now. We are still trying as we are en route, but as of right now, I've not been informed of any response.
Out of character, what does full mop gear mean?
Mop gear is something you wear for NBC, nuclear, biological, and chemical warfare. The suits are usually like charcoal lined, and then you have just like a gas mask. Would be the easiest way to explain it, to cover it.
Gotcha. Thank you.
There's different mop levels. Mop level 4 is the highest you can have. And that's like your full suit. Like if you
that's
just
like the full air pressured thing.
No, not air pressured. The military is not going to expend that much money on soldiers for that. If you just type in mop level 4 in Google, you'll see what I mean.
Alright.
Sounds like we're putting out more fires.
This is the military. There's always fires to put out.
Sergeant Ellis just kind of pulls out his wrench and kind of like waves it knowingly like, aye, aye, Captain.
So another question, just because I'm totally new to this whole mop thing, is that something that they're just going there unarmed, or would they have that? Would they have the gear and be armed?
They would. Well, we'll answer that when we get there. But as of right now, considering there's no response, they would go unarmed. I would order it as a captain that they go unarmed.
Okay, just wanted to be clear. All right, Captain, I will begin to rally the SEALs and go to the armory and get them equipped for this so that we can clear the submersible and make sure certain that it is safe.
Yes, permission to go prepare some supplies.
Make it so.
Yeah, the captain exits to go hurriedly back to the medical area and start pulling out all the emergency medical bags and adding anything she thinks might be helpful.
Captain turns to Hank. He goes, once we've arrived at the destination, depending on the situation, I might have you go in there and assess the ability of that ship to move on its own. If we need to send a skeleton crew over there to move it to port with us, or if we need to tow it in, I want an assessment on the readiness of its engine rooms when we arrive.
Hi, Captain. I'll check that out as soon as possible. Right on it.
Everyone dismissed.
Make it so is a perfect reference for 1992 for the record.
So first we're going to follow Dr. Jessica Perry. What does it look like as you exit the office? What are you thinking and feeling, and where are you going?
She's headed back, her mind racing, just so frustrated that they have no information about what they might be facing and how many people they might be taking aboard. She gets into the room and she says, we may be taking on some people who are in distress. We need to have the area prepped with multiple beds, gurneys, whatever we've got, get all the equipment we have sterilized, out and organized. Be prepared for anything, because honestly, I have no idea what to expect.
The PAs and the nurses, they're busy getting their supplies ready. They open a closet, and there are several duffel bags full of plastic gowns. There are some lead aprons and things they get out. They go into another closet, and there are tackle boxes. The med tech opens yet the third closet, and there are these giant kind of cartons on wheels that are color-coded. And the tech just says, whatever you want, you got it, Doc. Is this going on above decks? You know there's a storm going on.
Yeah, it's a submersible.
Roger that. Looks like we're all going to get wet.
Looks that way. Steady as she goes, and she picks up her bags and, you know, PPE and heads out.
There's like a small kind of surgical and resuscitation bay too on the ship, and as you walk out, there are the techs that man that part of the ship. And while you and your team are kind of going above board, you see a small army of surgical techs kind of going inside, and you can hear them chatting amongst themselves. They're kind of upset because the day shift got called back, and it's going to be in the middle of the night now, and they're going to have to operate possibly, and they're kind of complaining. This stuff happens from time to time, but on the vessel, you know, you're set to go home in a couple weeks, and everybody's kind of a little bit burnt out. They're kind of on their last leg as far as being able to tolerate each other's presence. So you walk up to the deck, and you can hear the thunder and the storm before you go above deck. But in the meantime, we're going to move back to Captain Lorenz. What are you doing?
He's trying to find out any information regarding submersible, if it's a certain class or type of submersible, if so, typical crew components. And then he's probably going to report to the comms officer and see if he can get any classified information on a Dr. Jen Milner or Jeff Milner. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how fast satellite comms were back then, but he'd look to see if he had access to any of that information. And any
probably
other...
have like just reams and reams of paper in your office with lots of bureaucratic stuff.
He has the printer with the perforations on the side.
The dot matrix, yeah.
The comms officer by now has been able to gather some really kind of rough kind of size specs and that sort of thing for the submersible, the engine signature from the sonar and that sort of thing, and he's giving you that data. And so you can try to piece this together if you want. And why don't you roll me a bureaucracy right. Check.
That's a roll.
I never thought you would use that in this game, but
any modifiers or anything?
No.
If there's one thing that happens in the military, it's mountains of paperwork and red tape, fortunately for someone like Captain Lorenz.
That's 9, 10, it's second level of success. So
that's part of boot camp.
You are able to locate a file on Milner. There is a kind of a classified binder you keep under your desk of things that may be going on in the area that you're not allowed to know much about. And with the two levels of success, basically, you're able to look him up. He's a former CDC official on a classified mission in the mid-Pacific. And then, like, almost everything after that is just blacked out. You know, every once in a while, there's some pronouns or some totally useless information. He's from Greenville, North Carolina. Did his research fellowship at Harvard. Did a little time at MIT as well. And then after that, just everything's blacked out. As far as the data on the submersible goes, you figure out that it's not of a military class. It's more of a class that you would expect on a research vessel. We've all seen the National Geographic specials, right, with those like really deep submersibles, and you're just like, probably would wonder like what, why, like you can't be that far out in the ocean with just that, right?
Yeah.
But you guys don't know anything else.
Captain Lorenz's brow furrows as he reads through this paperwork, kind of mumbling typical spook bullshit as he thinks of all the things that the left hand never truly knows what the right hand is doing in such a large apparatus as the United States military and Department of State. Just kind of grumbles to himself as he researches or looks through everything and then kind of notes that a submersible of that size shouldn't be out on its own. So then he instantly starts thinking of, well, where's its mothership?
Sergeant Hank Ellis, are you going to your engine room or whatever? Or what are you doing?
Yeah, Captain did release us, so I would have been
If everybody can't see,
area.
By the way, let me know. You should be able to see that, though.
Yeah, I can. Yeah, thank you. I'd go back in here and grab whatever tools I'm used to getting, a whole kit. I gotta get the spanner, gotta get this, all the things. Just a giant bag full of all kinds of crap that I gotta do to diagnose whatever might be wrong with this ship. You never really know. So, I don't want to make two trips. I move at a leisurely pace because my knees aren't what they used to be.
As you go down to the bowels of the ship, you smell cigarette smoke. And as you kind of round the corner, a couple of your leatherneck friends like hastily try to put it out. Oh, Sergeant, sorry, that was nothing. You didn't see that. We're just hanging out. Hey, looks like you got a load on there. Where are all those tools for?
Yeah, we got this submersible. We don't even know what's going on with it. We're just going to go see what's going on with it. They got some kind of medical urgency. They sent out a message. It's hard to understand. All I know is I got more crap to do. More of these. Sorry, the music is fantastic. First of all, don't smoke ever again down here. You know how many fires we've been putting out around here? Just don't. But tell you what, grab another bag and follow me up here.
Yeah, that guy kind of grinds the rest of the cigarette out with his boot, and you see that his buddy, you also know, kind of slides a bottle of that bathtub gin behind the pipe, and you hear the bottle scrape against the thing, and there's like a boombox down underneath the cabinet that's blaring out some Def Leppard. And say, oh, come on, Sarge, you're not going to ruin our party, are you? It's fucking storming up there.
He's like, yep, the party's up there. Follow me.
All right, you owe us one. I'm not cutting you in on any of this booze, Hank.
I'm getting too old for this.
All right, come on, Lenny. Go grab one of those burlap sacks in the toolbox. We're going to follow Sergeant Stick up his ass up above decks here.
Hey!
I didn't say nothing. Dude. That was the gin talking. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just shut up and walk.
Jen so, Parent. Yeah,
they can only walk as fast as I do as I'm in front of them.
right. Yeah. One of them smells like cigarettes and the other one smells like gin.
Mm. Yeah, party's over.
Tight ship here. Tight ship. Here, Captain.
Only the best
Lieutenant Jim Terrence.
So yeah, Lieutenant Tim or Jim walks in on his on a group of other Navy SEALs, and I picture them kind of all sitting around a table playing cards, just waiting out the storm, because for all intents and purposes, they don't know what's going on. And so Jim walks in. He's like, "All right, boys, we got a distress signal from a small submersible, or a submersible. I can't. We don't know the exact details on it yet. Captain has ordered us to get the full mop gear, and he's also ordered us to be armed to clear the vessel, and to make certain that." If there is anything there, that it's not getting out, anything dangerous. So I'm going to need you all to get ready to go, all right?
They look up from their hand of cards. There's four of them. They have their rifles kind of leaning against the table there. These guys are all pretty clean-cut looking. There's no aroma of cigarette smoke or bathtub gin. They look up at you. "How urgent is this, Lieutenant? I'm about ready to take the whole pot."
"Listen, finish up that hand, but after that hand, we got to get ready to go, because we don't know exactly what's on that ship. We know that it's at least 20 more kilometers out, so you got a minute, so finish your hand. But after that, we're going to go, and we need to get geared up and ready to get out of here."
"What are we expecting? Not expecting a fight, not this far out. Doesn't make any sense. Anyhow."
"Yeah, but we don't know what we're expecting." "Yeah.
Whatever you say, boss."
"Yeah, no, I appreciate it. Captain just wants to make certain that we're all safe, because we don't know what's going on. The thing that is the most disconcerting is that it's been in SOS and it's been on loop, and they're not responding to any of our hails. So because of that, we need to make certain, just take all precautions to be safe."
"Doesn't smell right to me out here in the middle of the ocean."
"Yeah, you're telling me. That's why I want you boys going home, right?"
"Yeah. All my brothers. We're going to set shore in San Diego in 2 weeks and tear up that town."
"Oh, shit. I'll be right there with you."
"All right. Well, if you got 20 clicks, that means we can feel you in a hand, Lieutenant."
Yeah, Lieutenant looks over his shoulder, kind of like left to the right, and kind of like looks at his watch and says, "Well, we got 15 minutes. And so then he pulls up a chair, like turns it backwards, sits on it, and he says, "I think you said you're about to take that pot? Well, I'm sorry there, friend. Lieutenant Jim is here." And he gives him a big smile.
"Give me... why don't you give me a ability check? This is the first time we'll do that. That way we can learn. Why don't you give me a perception? It's going to be what we call a complicated or more difficult perception check. If you look on your menu, there'll be two options. Mm-hmm. There's simple, and there's the other one's called like complicated or something like that. And give yourself a plus two to this, because you've lived with these guys for probably years at this point." Not very good at all.
"No.
Not very good at all.
I'm all bluster. All bluster. No action."
"Lieutenant Jim is here to give you his money."
Yeah. Instead, one of your good buddies from back in San Diego, he takes the pot, takes whatever you paid in. You play a few more hands. You may win one of them. But overall, your guys fleece you. And they say, "Well, I guess this little meeting above deck is worth it. I'm a rich man. Hey, first round on me and the SD, boys."
"Yeah, yeah, yeah. Get suited up. Time to go." He glowers, but also gives them kind of a smirk.
They all kind of gear up, and they have a boombox as well with a CD in it, playing some tracks from Pearl Jam's first album.
Hell yeah.
And maybe a half hour passes by, and I'm going to get all the tokens together, and we're going to go back above decks. find the dock. There's the dock. You all good?
Yes, sir.
Yep.
Cool. Yep.
All right. So there's probably lots of med techs up there. A couple SEALs you brought up, some engineers, a lot of kind of run-of-the-mill sailors on board, kind of looking down towards the ocean. The ocean is angry this day, my friends. The waves are 10 meters high, crashing against the carrier, but the carrier is just so enormous that you only feel a slight sway. And I'll let you role play what it looks like as you guys go up above decks.
Dr. Perry's wearing rain gear and carrying two big bags of medical equipment. She's changed her shoes for something more practical for the slick conditions, and she pulls the hood down further over her face against the fierce rain that's coming down, and looks around trying to spot the other members of this expedition, the other people going over to the submersible.
Yeah. Are all the engineering team, we're all geared up for the hazmat stuff is for all intents and purposes as well?
Yeah. You can't smell the gin through the N95, unfortunately.
There you go. That's what it's for. Cover up the smell of those Virginia Slims my guys were smoking.
What type of sailors are these? I guess it is the Navy.
It's the Navy, baby.
Captain is out with the rain gear on as he kind of looks out to the distance and looks to the doctor and Lieutenant and Hank and goes, I have over 6,000 people on this ship. I do not take putting their lives at risk lightly. I want in, out, secure the sick and those that are more injured, apparently. Get them to the quarantine zone on the hangar one. And from there, we will assess from there and get them to the infirmary if need be for additional treatment. Doctor, I want you to communicate through the lieutenant if there's anything more serious. And once the ship is secured, I will come aboard myself. I want to see what's going on.
Yeah, so Lieutenant Jim is there with his SEALs. They're all listening intently, and you see that the bearing, kind of the calm, fun-loving bearing that he had below deck with the SEALs when they were playing a game is now replaced by just man of business. And so all of them are putting the finishing touches on their gear. They have their SC, their masks just ready to put on at a moment's notice. And otherwise, Jim is kind of relaying the orders of the captain to them. And also, he's like saying, all right, so you, Jerry, gonna need you to guard the entrance. And you, Robert, I'm gonna need you to do this. And so he's kind of giving out the more minutiae of the orders to follow along with what the captain wants.
How are we getting to the submersible?
Oh, I'm assuming it surfaced, and when we arrived to it, I'm sure they have some sort of not necessarily ladder, but
some kind of bridge. We're sailors. We know what we're doing.
Yeah. So the moon is blotted out by the dark clouds overhead.
Yeah.
As this crystalline rain crashes out onto the deck, giving the deck an orange sheen against the caution lights that are illuminating the carrier deck. And in between claps of thunder and flashes of lightning, you can see a slender cigar-shaped outline of something on the surface as the pilot kind of radios in on Captain Lorenz. Bring it around to starboard. 2 more degrees. Okay, engines in reverse. Captain, give the board order if you need it. We're within range of our embarking equipment.
Thank you, sir. Kind of turns to the group. Now remember, no mistakes. In, out, rescue them. Let's get back to the States. If there's any issues, contact me.
Hi, Captain. Let's move quick. And he starts moving as quick as he does.
Yeah, Lieutenant Jim's probably the when the embarking equipment is created the bridge and ready to go over. Him and his team are probably the first one to clear it out and make certain that it's safe.
That's you. Yeah. Go ahead. You roll play one second.
Oh. The doctor's going in behind you guys, letting the military in first, but she's obviously agitated and uncomfortable with not being in control of the situation.
Hmm. How big of a submersible, now that we're actually there, we were assuming it was like a personal submersible, how big are we talking? Now that we can see it and are close.
It can fit a couple dozen people. It's not a huge submarine, but it can fit a couple dozen people, if that makes sense. So it's smaller than the picture.
Yeah. Gotcha.
So hard to find a picture of this sort of stuff at night. So as you approach the bridge, the hatch opens up, and a man with dark brown hair, wearing a kind of soot-covered lab coat, pops his head above deck.
Oh, thank goodness! I didn't know if our prayers had been answered, but it does appear they have. Oh, to who do I owe the pleasure? Dr. Jeff Milner of this fine vessel. Oh, heaven's sake, we thought we were all going to die out here in the middle of the Pacific.
Lieutenant Jim Terrence, part of the aircraft carrier. We're here because we received a SOS signal. You haven't responded to any of our hails.
Our transmitter got fried with lots of our other equipment. I can explain more, but we have sick and injured all downstairs. Can you help us get them out? Some burned. There are a couple of scrapes and bruises. Some unfortunately suffering from radiation sickness.
Oh geez, we'll come and take a look at your equipment, see what you got working with. You fried everything. Golly, come on guys, let's go. I immediately want to go toward whatever kind of control room, you know.
So
that's my intention is to head that direction.
With my before he gets on, Jim kind of like puts a hand up, almost, you know, like over his chest, and he looks at Dr. Jeff and he says, "Sir, what do you know what caused the damages? What do we need to be on the lookout for?"
I do say we are far away from the source of our current problem. Unfortunately, it's classified. I'm not comfortable saying it right here in front of all these folks, but there was an accident involving radiation and an EMP charge. Once we get on board, I can tell you more. Is your commanding officer nearby?
He is on deck, sir. First, Roger our that. Doctor will have to be able to give you the clear, but we're gonna me and my team are gonna go down there and ascertain just the damage from the situation.
Yeah, at the word radiation, she's reaching in her bags and pulling out. I don't remember what they're called, but
Geiger counter,
right?
The appropriate material. Awesome.
Yeah.
Yep. And who's all kind of inside the vessel?
I'm assuming.
So it's only the doctor who came out.
His head. Yeah. Are you? Is it just you then? Jim Terrence, like the doctor Jeff, kind of poked his head out, but he would like let you guys on board, obviously, to save his people.
Yeah. Lieutenant Jim would look at the doctor and look at Sergeant Hank, and he said, really think the captain would like for us to make certain that it's safe before going on board.
Yes, that mention of radiation is troubling, and she's kind of fiddling with the dials. We definitely need to make sure that that's not going to be an issue. So I'll come in right behind your men, and if anything troubling starts coming up on the counter, then we'll need to back out until we have proper protection.
Yeah, Lieutenant General nodded that.
Sorry. We got a nuclear sub. We're just going to need to evacuate everyone off the sub. It's not going to be safe for anybody on there.
Correct.
What's up?
Oh, yeah, is it a nuclear sub?
This isn't a nuclear sub. They were exposed to radiation.
What the hell? How else are you going to get... Oh, right. That's... This is just my assumption, I guess. Considering radiation.
Yeah.
On a sub.
Yeah. All right. Well, Jessica, keep that Geiger counter going. Keep it going, and we'll go. We'll continue to clear the room. Go one by one. And Dr. Jeff, you can continue to tell us more as we get on the sub with you. And Lieutenant Jim will make his way down the hatch with his team.
Okay, Jessica Perry, give me a. I don't think you have. It's not really the medicine. Do psychology. Do intelligence, complicated intelligence. With -1, you probably have some training in this sort of thing, but it's like, you know, just like I have hazmat training.
Right.
Oh, that is one level of success. So you barely know how to work the instrument, but you know that it's not normal. It's not like all the way over in the range. So give me a medicine check with no mods.
Okay.
That's one level of success as well. Again, you probably had some training regarding radiation illness and exposure, since you're going to be on a large military vessel. Radiation levels unsafe, certainly enough to cause illness, but not like immediately deadly or anything like that. Type of radiation exposure that increases cancer risk 20 years down the road, that sort of thing.
Right, something that prolonged would be a major issue, but for us going on to the ship is probably not going to be a big issue.
Right. But Lieutenant Jim does see, like, as you enter down into the vessel, there are, like, your boots stick, and you just, that smell of vomit just hits your nostrils, that acidy, acrid smell of vomit, and you see some of the faces of the people on board look like they've been, have, like, a really, really bad sunburn, and all of them kind of clamor towards the deck. Let me out of here! Let me out of here! Oh, Jesus! We're at the surface. Oh, you're a goddamn angel. Oh.
Lieutenant, I'm getting some definite readings on the counter, but enough to explain some illness. It's a pretty serious illness, but I think brief exposure is not putting any of our men at risk.
Dr. Jessica, if and he's, you know, the seals are... coming down behind him, presumably, and he's kind of like motioning them to different doors to check on people. Dr. Jessica, while I'm coordinating this, if you'd please convey all of what we know thus far to the captain to keep him in the loop.
Yes. So I guess we've got walkie-talkies?
Yeah, absolutely. What's Hank Ellis doing?
I actually would wonder if I could do some kind of roll. It seems like I would be able. You said it's not necessarily a nuclear sub, but it seems like I'd be able to identify it as an engineer. a lot to experience in the Navy.
Yep. And do you have physics as well?
Let me double check. Get my character sheet. I just go straight to the old skill check.
Oh yeah, yours just the science. I meant to put science dash physics in there. I just forgot to type it.
Yeah, it's just science and there's the engineering. There's mechanic.
Probably not mechanics is like fixing stuff.
Sure.
Science or engineering, either one would work.
Sure, I'll just go ahead and roll. That's engineering. It makes more sense. I'll go ahead and roll the engineering check.
Go inside with them to help out?
Yeah. I mean, I kind of feel like I would have right there from the surface been able to look around it to try to identify it from the outside.
Okay. You have a negative two.
Great. I'll take that. That's going to help a lot. Go ahead and roll it. He's cocky. He's been around for a while. Nope. Guess what he rolls?
No. 9 and 10 is first level success. So,
awesome.
Unfortunately, with the waves and everything going on and the rain and the dark, just like rolling in the waves, you can't quite make out that much about what's going on.
What the hell is this mysterious sub? Go ahead and proceed in. Curious to know more about it.
What's the cap doing?
Captain, upon being relayed this information, kind of surprised at it being radiation related, as someone who oversees a 1,000-foot nuclear powered mini city. He issues orders to the quarantine zone in the hangar to begin preparations to treat for radiation exposure, basically setting up hazmat bags for the people to deposit their clothes in, perhaps a makeshift shower to hose off the rest of any sort of radioactive particles. Probably issues one of the engineers to start handing out dosimeters to any of the medical staff to track radiation exposure levels, and kind of modifies a typical radiation leak or exposure event on a aircraft carrier and modifies it for this specific instance, and then just waits for more information as they continue to explore the submersible.
And I want Sergeant Hank Ellis, mm-hmm. Jim Terrence, and Jessica Perry all to roll mm-hmm. me just a D10.
Your D10.
Oh no!
Got it.
Classic Ellis.
All right. So, what you guys find down there? 24 individuals. Jeff Milner looks like he's burned a little bit. Almost all of them have, after you've been to the beach, that like bad sunburn you develop under your eyes. Almost all of them tend to have that. But towards the back of the sub, there's like six people who are like laid out, almost minimally responsive. And there's a bloody diarrhea just pooled underneath them. You can't right. smell it. I guess you couldn't have smelled the vomit either with the N95 on, but you just step in it and just look down and just bloody diarrhea. One of them turns over, just vomits, and it's bloody, and their hair is just coming out gobs already.
Their hair is coming out, you said?
Yes.
It seems like they got a worse they got worse exposure than the rest of the crew.
Yikes. So these roles that we did, is there any consequences or like a thing we should keep in mind?
That's for me to know.
Okay, for you to know. Gotcha. Making sure, I'm like, so do I see the bloody stool that I'm stepping in? Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
So Lieutenant Jim, I only say Lieutenant Jim just to clarify between Captain Jim. Lieutenant Jim looks down at all of them. He's like, son of a bitch. And he, his first instinct at that is to look around at his surroundings and see if there's anything that is causing that, in the immediate Yeah, I'll just call him Terrence. That's smart. So yeah, Terrence looks around at his immediate surroundings to see if there's anything that's causing that, because he's worried about him and his team and all the other people as the point man. Does he see anything?
No, you don't. And Dr. Perry's Geiger counter stays pretty flat at the same rate. You'd probably surmise, just like somebody said, that, you know, when this event happened, whatever happened, I mean, the people that were right there just got blasted with it. And everybody else got a lesser dose. And what you're seeing now is just kind of the off-gassing of that radiation.
So, assuming that Dr. Jessica is with me, Jim would, or Terrence, god dang it, would look back and say, Doctor, these folks are in really bad shape. Is there any specific way we should transport them or just get them the hell out of here ASAP?
She looks at them and she says the people that are capable of moving under their own power, that's not going to be a problem, and this all does look radiation induced. I'm not too worried about a contagion issue. The others, well, I'm going to need to assess them probably individually there. We may need to bring stretchers over to carry them back to the ship.
Okay, so yeah, Terrence looks at his men and he's like, all right, you take a... Have we at this point investigated the entire submersible and it's just these six people left?
Yeah, so like what I say, two dozen, so... you know, the first 18 of them are kind of walking wounded types, right? And so if you want, they could go to like the decontamination showers and stuff like that. While the six, I mean, they're close to death even. Apparently they're minimally responsive. Dr. Perry could probably figure out more if she wanted to, you know, do some exams and stuff. But
yeah. Jim will order his SEALs on standby until he gets the word from Dr. Jessica to transport them.
Yeah, she gets on the walkie-talkie and, you know, communicates what she's found in her assessment to the captain, that they're going to need people going to the decontamination showers, the ones that can walk under their own power, others... And she kind of moves away from anyone from this ship as she does so. She says, we may just be making them comfortable on their way out.
Have we ever seen anything like this? This has got to be, like, shocking for us, I imagine.
Yeah.
Just wanted to double check. Like, oh, you know, Tuesdays, am I right?
Certainly would be. Certainly would. Dr. Perry, as a military doc, probably has seen some really bad stuff, and I think the SEAL would have as well. But Hank Ellis, this is a good time to do a fear check.
Yeah,
thanks for giving me some fodder. Giving me some fodder there. Yeah. Always good. So here's fear. So basically, it's just a difficult willpower test, okay? So use that complicated willpower test and see what you get.
Willpower. Just for me, though. Everyone else is like, Mondays.
Yeah.
Is there a modifier? I've done complicated. Should I add a modifier as well?
Nope, just complicated enough.
Got it.
Excuse me.
Oh, no. I rolled a four.
So that's a negative. So when you roll that, I didn't add any mods. Roll me a d10.
Got it.
Eight. Okay. And what's your character's willpower? It's not going to matter much. Basically, you're just kind of, and you can just role play this throughout how you're starting to get rattled. In combat, you might freeze or even miss a turn with this sort of thing. But in this situation, you just are overwhelmed for several seconds. It might have a slight freak out, but it's not going to affect you mechanics-wise. So I'll just let you roleplay what that looks like.
Yeah, no, that's fine. That'll be natural to be freaked out by all this. So, Jesus, bloody shit all over my boots. Fair enough.
So, what does he do?
Oh gosh, again, he wants to play it confident. He knows he's in charge of his little crew, and so he keeps his he pretends like he's stammering a little bit, but he pretends like he's like, all right, we got some nuclear issues over here, so he wants to look at that.
I think Terrence and Perry would probably sense that Ellis is getting a little flustered.
Yeah.
Terrence would look over at Ellis and he's like, and just put a hand on him and he's like, it's okay, man. Just, I think I saw what you were looking for in that hallway over there.
So the suits that we put on ought to protect from nuclear radiation?
Dr. Perry doesn't seem terribly concerned about it.
Great.
Okay,
so I put on, as an engineer, I ought to know if my suit is protecting me or not from certain threats. So, relatively confident, despite the fact that this is super upsetting to see all these guys really messed up. He'll go ahead and head that direction.
After telling people to prep stretchers over on the main ship, I think Dr. Perry would walk over to the really sick people, trying to avoid the worst of the mess on the floor, and she smiles through her PPE, even though they probably can't see her mouth. Maybe they can see the crinkles around her eyes, and says, you know, she tries to say some comforting things to them. You know, help's here. We're gonna get you all taken care of. And maybe feel a few pulses and, maybe use a stethoscope on a couple of them. She's more kind of going through the motions because I think in her mind she thinks they're probably a lost cause.
They're done for.
They're gonna get a morphine drip when they get back.
There's a red-haired woman who only has very few crumps of red hair. It's like a top knot almost, if the only hair remaining. And she rolls over to you and her eyes are just sunken into her skull as she's lost all of her volume through vomit and having diarrhea. And she starts to speak to you, and you see that her mouth and lips are just cracked and bloody. So what happens with this radiation? All your fast reproducing cells just die. And it's just like a bloody, raw mouth. And she says, what is your name?
I'm Dr. Perry. What's your name?
My name is Margaret. Am I going to die, Doctor?
We're all going to die at some point, Margaret, but when we get you back to the ship, you're going to receive the best care possible.
She kind of looks. I'm so sorry. I did not think it would end like this. I'm so sorry.
And she rolls over and just, ugh! Now it's just blood coming up.
And Dr. Perry kind of steps back instinctively and, kind of assumes that she's just a little confused because of dehydration and all of her sickness. This can't possibly be this woman's fault.
Yeah. As all of this is going on, Terrence is communicating all of this to the captain, keeping him in the loop. About the 18 folks who are essentially walking wounded, and about the 6 who look to have received a worse dose of this radiation. Captain, I don't know what's going on here. What I can tell you right now is that there's still low levels of radiation throughout this sub. Nothing that should make us any long-term sick or anything. But there's 6 folks here who, Captain, they're in real bad shape. bloody vomit, bloody stool, and they look like they are, I'm assuming he's like actually taken, he's like maybe in like the next room, because he doesn't want to talk in front of these people to get rid of any hope that they might have. Captain, they really look like they're on their last leg. Dr. Jessica is doing what she can, but we might need, it looks bad.
Captain kind of thinks as he hears this over the radio and understood, Lieutenant. I will divide the quarantine into two areas, one for the 18 walking wounded to begin the decontamination process. I will set up some mobile gurneys, some tables for this critical care, and I will bring in staffing accordingly. We will see if there's anything we can do for them. You said this is primarily radiation. There's no sign of contagion, like originally believed.
Yeah, it does not appear that there's anything to be contagion. What I will say is the Dr. Milner said something about radiation and an EMP, which seems odd, especially we don't know what type of sub this is. But might be wise to get to the bottom of that.
Is it functional? What did Petty Officer Ellis say?
Petty Officer Ellis is still going through the checks to ascertain whether or not this is the submersible is recoverable. From what Dr. Milner said, it sounded like there was a singular event that happened. We don't know what, but that caused some type of mechanical damage to the sub itself. Dr. Ellis is still figuring out what the extent of that damage is and hopefully getting to the root of it. When I inquired Dr. Milner earlier to ask, to give us some more details, just to know whether or not we'll be safe, he said that it was essentially above my pay grade, that it's classified.
Hmm. If he wants to stay on this ship, he'll be sharing his secrets with me. Escort, when ready, at your discretion, escort the 18 to the quarantine. The Marines will take it from there along with some of my seamen. They will see that everything is disposed of properly, and then tell this Dr. Milner that I will speak with him in private in the hangar once the doctor has returned from caring for these six critical individuals.
Hi. Dr. Milner should already be approaching quarantine. It might be wise to check in with the quarantine, because unfortunately I won't be able to relay that message. What I will have is my SEALs escort the 18, and I'll keep one and myself behind to stay with Ellis and Dr. Perry.
Very well. And Bo, quickly, how long is the swarm approximately going to last?
All night.
Okay. Once we have the injured cared for, we will begin decontamination protocols of this submersible. If it is functional, it will follow us in. If not, we will tow it, or worst case scenario, set it for demo once we've retrieved all info and intel.
Captain. So yeah, after that, Lieutenant Jim will make his way back, confer with the SEALs and have them beginning to escort the 18 up onto the decks, and he and another SEAL will stay behind to keep an eye on Perry, Ellis, and the six remaining individuals.
The scene is one of controlled chaos up on the deck. The crew of the USS Nordstrom vastly outnumbers the 24 folks from the submersible, and a quarantine area has been set up on deck. It's like an inflatable tent, and the SEALs are stripping down all the walking wounded, stripping them naked, making them walk through these showers. It's kind of redundant with this pouring, drenching downpour that's going on, and half of them are crying. Some of them are asking about their friends, which may be one of the sicker ones. There's every once in a while, somebody just kind of collapses and loses their shit on the deck. I'll let you guys kind of role play what you think and feel about that, and then what it looks like as you bring the critical patients down to give them treatment.
The doctor is...
Everybody would have to be deconned, even sick. Yeah. So you'd have to just go wash them down, yeah.
The doctor closely supervises, you know, the transfer of the critically ill people over to the stretchers that are taking them back, and she, speaks to them as often as she can, trying to keep their spirits up a little bit, but her brows are furrowed. As the rain comes down, I guess they do what they can to protect the people from that additional exposure. Are there pills you can take to decrease
iodine,
the
right?
effect of?
There's iodine stuff.
Yeah, so she'll also start, trying to communicate with staff to bring the right sort of iodine or whatever the drugs are that can help reduce the effects of low exposure to radiation.
And after decon, I mean, everybody's pretty clean now that you guys are away from the sub. So kind of moving on to the second stage here, all the survivors of that submersible are kind of decon, and like they're probably given maybe something like scrubs or maybe like old Navy fatigues or something to wear, and I don't know, you're going to usher them somewhere. But what do you want to do with these critically ill folks?
So my idea was basically below deck in one of the many hangars, there's enough space, like the inflatables that you were talking about. You could probably set up a mobile aid station and care for them there. And once Dr. Perry thinks they're safe or need to be transferred to the infirmary, Captain Lorenz would authorize that. As for the 18 others, he'd probably have a temporary area, since there's limited space on one of the hangars, with like cots or something for them to hang out, and then authorize the some chow to be brought out to them.
Yeah, Terrence, I kind of picture him, you know, being one of the last people off of the submarine, making certain that these the six critical are getting off safely. Just making certain, then after the last one is kind of off, going back down to Ellis to kind of like relieve the seal that was with him, staying behind, and him just looking at Ellis and saying, all right, do you have any answers? Because we need to get back on the ship.
Yeah. What may have this whole time I've been just working it and trying to just look at the machines, forget what I saw. So what might I have discovered in whatever I was investigating in that control room or engine room?
Yeah, I think while you were inside, once you went inside, you could probably get a better look at everything, right?
Sure.
So you can get a look at the
role of engineering
and that sort of thing. Yeah. Sure. Maybe I'll give you more if you did really well.
Just no modifier. Or?
No modifier.
Gotcha.
Hey.
That's one level of success. You can't ascertain, you know, a lot of details. It might be that you're kind of upset and frazzled from what happened, but it does look like a lot of the instruments weren't designed to withstand a pulse of radiation, and so a lot of the more detailed instruments that would be on the submersible are just absolutely fried. You don't see anything terribly mechanically wrong with the submersible. There's no cracks in the hull. There's no evidence of corrosion or anything like that. No evidence they've been attacked.
Yeah. So as far as I can tell, she should still be able to able to swim. It should be working just fine. But we got to know what kind of ship. What are they doing out here? Who are these people?
I'll tell you what, I got... Yeah, I think those are really good questions, and hopefully the captain can get to the bottom of it. I know that he wanted to talk to that Dr. Milner guy, so if you think that, does it look at least like the sub is operational? Because the captain wanted to know whether or not we needed to tow it, or whether it can go on its own.
What do you say, ZM?
Nope. Nope. No operation.
Not currently operational.
If it was operational, it would be stranded.
Fair enough. Yeah. No, it's not going anywhere. It's gonna stay right here. We could probably repair it. Give it enough time, you know.
All right. I think that'll be a good enough answer for the captain for right now. Why don't we head up? There's a whole lot of people that need our help up there.
Yeah, there's not a lot I can do here with what I've got. We'll have to go get some more more equipment to get this place fixed up.
Sounds good. And with that, Terrence will make his way out with a submersible and up onto the deck with Alice.
Dr. Lorenz, Dr. Lorenz, Jim wanted to talk to Milner.
Which one? Which Jim?
It's Captain
Jim.
Captain. Captain Jim.
Are you muted? WP?
All right, there. So one thing, if possible, once everybody's transferred and waiting, he's going to wait until everybody's back to talk with this Dr. Milner. He will call for his intel officer, and once the ship's been deconned, he'll probably try a transfer of materials over to the aircraft carrier for safekeeping, because obviously whatever they were down there for, they want to bring their findings with them.
Yeah, there are several binders that you find of papers, scientific papers and whatnot.
In that case, yeah. Basically, he's going to wait to, as soon as they're deconned, he's going to want to talk to Dr. Milner and see what's being brought aboard his ship and what they were doing down there.
All right. We'll have that conversation. Doesn't have to necessarily be in your office. It could be somewhere else.
We'll pretend it's in the quarantine area because he's not going to give him free range of the ship just yet, but in a private kind of conversation.
Let's do this area then. Here, let me move you around. There you go.
Dr. Milner, I'll be frank. I don't know why you're out here. I don't know why your submersible is in this position. I've heard some interesting reports from my lieutenant, as well as the doctor. My first question to you is, where is your mothership? Why are you out here by yourself?
He looks around. Is there anybody present that looks like they may not have security clearance or just pull him aside?
No, this would be a one-on-one conversation to start.
All right. Very well. I don't know if I should be doing this, but I suppose this qualifies as an extenuating circumstance. Some years ago, the United States authorized underwater bases at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. You've been operating since, I believe, 1989, we first got down there. People have come and gone, and you've heard the rumors about Area 51, all those sorts of things. This is in a similar category. But to tell you the truth, Captain, it's not that complex. It makes complete and total sense for the U.S. Department of State to maintain a presence at the bottom of the Pacific. With the rise of nuclear power, the engineering feat was not that hard.
It was just a simple accident that led to this. We got out what few we were able to save. Unfortunately, there are many souls still at the bottom of the ocean that are meeting or have met their demise. Can you give me a questioning check?
I can.
Oh, dang!
That's wow. Rule of tens. We can go over that. So click that rule of ten. Oh, I get to add the whole five, so that is 24. So you can hit roll the 10 again. 24, so that's 26.
Dang.
This is the highest level you can get. It's off the outcome chart, I believe.
This guy's been dying to spill his guts to someone.
The captain.
Yeah, right?
He might have it.
The captain slams his fist against, a makeshift table that they were kind of opposite of each other. Goes, damn it! You're putting my men in jeopardy by putting us out in this storm. You're telling me you're at the bottom of the base, and now I have 6 people potentially dying, 18 that have suffered radiation sickness. You will tell me what you were doing down there, and you will tell me now, or you will be back on the submersible at the your own peril.
Oh, dang.
Milner has had a long night. He's had radiation sickness. He's probably shat his brains out, but he's functional. He looks up at Captain. You're right. There's nothing more to hide. Kind of looks around. Like I said, I suppose these are extenuating circumstances. I'm going to tell you everything. And I'm going to tell you everything right now. As that happens, there is a scene change to the makeshift critical care unit off of the quarantine area. The scene is one of, again, controlled chaos as the medical tech nurses and Dr. Perry's assistants go from one patient to another. There's 6 patients there, a whole spectrum of disease. One they're pretty sure is going to make it, some IV fluids. A couple of them, like Dr. Perry said, are circling the drain. And there's those in the middle that might go one way or the other. They might find peace here in annihilation in the middle of the Pacific, where they might recover one day to step foot again in San Diego. Jim Terrence and Hank Ellis are nearby helping the doctor in whatever way they can as they're working on one particular researcher. The researcher's naked on the bed. What looks to be first, second degree burns, peeling skin over most of his body. He's long lost any contents of his colon that was there. And so now blood is just pouring out of his anal orifice. Thanks. And he's been intubated and blood is spewing from around the endotracheal tube as the medical tech just keeps dialing up the settings on the vent. Doc, we've maxed PEEP, we've maxed FiO2. I don't know what else you want us to do for this guy.
Is this one of the sickest ones or one of the kind of ones that might make it?
One that might make it.
Yeah, she's gonna turn from the other patient she was working on and then walk over there and say, let me have another look. She'll check his vitals and kind of search her knowledge of anything else that might help in this situation. Is there anything that they could do that they haven't?
Why don't you give me a medicine check with a straight up medicine roll. Did pretty good. Yep. Yeah. You listen to his lungs, and you adjust some settings on the ventilator. You give him more time to breathe, basically.
you explain something to the tech about his lungs being stiff, and he needs more time to exhale, and this should stabilize him. And you feel pretty good about that. Hank and Terrence, what are you up to?
Gosh, I feel like Hank would have probably actually thrown up upon seeing this man just shit pure blood all over the table. Just as a reflex. He didn't mean to. He's not, you know, he tried to hold it back, but, you know, some things are just so gross. It just makes you throw up without wanting to.
You also, after you throw up, you figure it's from being in that mop suit and vomiting, but you have a horrible headache, Hank. You have a horrible headache and a sore throat.
I probably wouldn't tell anybody about it, because there's triage, there's people who are worse off than I am, so I just kind of let it go. I try to suck it up. It's the classic, got bit by a zombie, didn't tell anybody.
Jim and Jessica Perry, I would like you guys to both roll a D10. Got it. Alright, so Hank told me what he's doing. Terrence, what are you up to? How are you feeling about this whole situation?
Yeah, I think Terrence is, he has, I think he's anxious just because there's so much more that's still unknown. And so I think he's, you know, I picture him out in the, so am I kind of in the hospital room with Dr. Perry and Ellis just watching all of this?
Or is
this outside on the triage?
You could be wherever you want.
Okay, so then, yeah, I picture him out on the deck just doing what he can to kind of help coordinate and work on the triage efforts, making certain that people are quarantined, helping to do whatever he can. He's just trying to work off whatever anxiety or nervousness he has. And so he's gotten like increasingly more gruff as this night has gone on, and he's just barking orders at his SEALs, like, make certain to keep an eye on this, and hey, I need you to go grab this for me, and just like just doing whatever he can to stay busy.
Got it. Back in the quarantine, or in the makeshift ICU, the medical tech and Perry and Ellis are working on this guy, and he seems to have taken a turn for the better. The tech's like, Dr. Perry, we've been through a lot together, but nothing like this. You know, once we get back to San Diego, I've been thinking about, applying to medical school with all this, you know, all this experience. You know, who's going to turn me down, right?
Well, I would certainly write you a recommendation. Yeah, I think you'd be walking in with a world of experience that that other medical students couldn't dream of. So if that's the direction you want to go, I certainly encourage it.
Now, well, we got 2 more weeks at sea. I'll just write up a personal statement and have it ready by the time we walk ashore. Thanks a lot. I've been really nervous about asking you for a favor.
Well, you should never feel nervous about asking me for something like that. But I'm afraid that we may not have a whole lot of free time for composing letters during these last 2 weeks. And she kind of looks around at all the chaos. But we'll get it done, one way or another.
He smiles and nods, and you can see through his glasses, his eyes are just brimming with happiness, and he smiles from beneath his mask. He reaches his right hand over the patient as if to shake your hand, when suddenly, Dr. Perry, out of the corner of your eye, you see this researcher open his eyes, and fast as a snake, he sits up in bed with the endotracheal tube still in his mouth, and grabs the medical tech's arm, biting into it. Blood sprays radial blood sprays into the room. Not on you, Dr. Perry. You step aside. It doesn't get as far as Dr. Ellis. But the medical tech, God damn it! Get him off of me! Get him off of me! This guy now takes the medical tech's head and just starts smashing his own head into it.
Dr. Perry starts calling for help. You know, we need some restraint over here. We need some tranquilizers. And she'll start calling for, you know, whatever, CCs of whatever to put him down.
The medical tech just rips himself off. His arms just de-glove. He falls to the floor. He starts to shake.
Yeah, Dr.
Just within seconds. Go ahead.
Dr. Perry rushes over to his side as I'm assuming other people come to try to restrain this researcher.
Yeah, I'm going to be right on top of the guy who bit him. I'm going to try to hold him down.
So is one of the nurses. One of the nurses goes and tries to hold him down too, but she gets the medical tech treatment. This guy takes two gobs out of this nurse's red hair, rips them out, brings down her neck onto the only teeth that he has like left in his mouth, rips open her carotid artery.
Where are those tranquilizers?
All over the room.
Is there like an emergency button that she can, or?
Yeah, there's like a panic button. There's a panic button.
Yeah, she's gonna hit the panic button.
As you hit the panic button, you see the med tech stand up. And he's shaking. Your PA, your physician assistant, the coward he is, he's trying to get out, but he can't find the door lock, and suddenly the medical tech is on him. His hands around the guy's neck, he takes the physician assistant's head and takes it and smashes it repeatedly on the stainless steel sink. Get him off me! Get him off me! And suddenly he goes unconscious, a pool of blood spreading on the floor. And then even Jim Terrence, from somewhere on the ship, you hear a scream, and you hear gunfire. And we're going to switch scenes back to Jeff Milner and Lieutenant Jim Lorenz. They haven't heard anything yet. It just hasn't quite happened. So Jim Lorenz slams the wall. Tell me everything you know. And Milner says, I suppose it's extenuated circumstances. You might want to take a seat, Captain. What I have to tell is quite a disturbing story.
Spit it out now.
Some years ago, researchers near the polar ice cap uncovered what we are affectionately now calling in the science community an archaeoprion. This is something foreign to modern man. You saw through my little lies. There was, you know, our research station is nuclear powered, but it wasn't built for security reasons. It was built to study these things and safety. It's very dangerous. It has been inviolable for study, though. You just wouldn't want this thing in a lab in your backyard, if you know what I mean.
Dangerous.
It's extremely infectious. It causes anyone infected to develop extreme sense of rage and violence. Uncontrollable. Have you ever been skydiving, Captain Lorenz?
I'm a man of the sea, not the air. Why?
Well, I suppose the adrenaline rush you would get going 0 to 60 miles an hour and 2 miles above the earth is probably half what someone infected with this virus would feel. The catecholamine surge we've sensed in the brain of the infected are off the charts.
How many of your people are infected?
None. We got out in time. The facility, we call it Deep Horizon. Yes. On my honor. We got off. We activated the code red. We started a meltdown of the reactor. We did get blasted by a good bit of radiation as a nuclear-powered sub-oceanic research facility would, but
It was just an accident. We used protocol. We got out in time before anything could happen.
Is this by contact or airborne? I need to know details. I have a ship of 6,000 people to look after.
It's complicated.
Don't get complicated.
It's science. It's complicated, Captain. If we knew everything that was going on, we wouldn't have had to abandon the research facility, and we wouldn't have had the accident.
He kind of runs his hand over his face for a moment, incredibly angry at the news he's getting. He knows he's going to have to file some sort of report with his senior officers or the fleet admiral, and I'll have more questions for you later. In the meantime, and he kind of goes to makes haste for a wall phone or something to get a hold of the XO.
That's when you hear the screaming from the nearby quarantine area where the makeshift ICU was done.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when Dr. Perry hits the alarm too.
The captain runs to the nearest intercom or phone and calls general quarters and battle stations for the ship. And then he goes running towards the quarantine area, and kind of as he runs past Doctor, he goes, "You're coming with me." And when it's not a request.
And back on deck with Jim Terrence, you heard the gunshot happen like from far away, but from down below, you hear the screaming from the quarantine area. What are you doing?
I would run towards the. I think my number one priority would be safe. So just so I'm clear about the layout, is the makeshift ICU area the same place that the doctor is currently working in?
Yes.
Okay, that is where he would go to, because he also got a call or summons, right? There was some Dr. Jessica put out some call, so that's where he's going to.
Yep, that's where that alarm blaring, right?
Mm. Yeah, just running with all haste, and if he sees a seal, he's like, "Come with me now!" And just makes his way as fast as he can.
Several Navy SEALs fall in line with you, and you head down. The metal stairwell going down to the hangar. And the very last SEAL that was kind of in line, you see through the rain just somebody jump on his back.
Pull it off of me! Pull it off of me!
What do you do?
Yeah, I think Jim goes over there and he does what he can to like pull that guy off of him.
So you see a figure kind of rise up, your brother, your Navy SEAL brother, is not moving, and just kind of rising over him through the rain is one of your fellow sailors, just blood all over his face. Rain pouring down over him, and he's about 10 meters from you at this point, and he just kind of looks at you. What do you do?
I'm so sorry, who are you talking to?
Terrence. I'm sorry, I forgot I was on push to talk, my bad. Yeah, he sees that one of these sailors took down one of his brothers, and he's just like, "Fuck!" And he brings up just feels weapons free, brings up a gun, and tries to shoot this guy that brought one of his guys down.
Give me a fear check. So it's a complicated willpower. And it's going to be at a -2. That's a failure. So you're going to get
-2.
Yep.
going to get a negative 2 on your shot. So okay. Roll your opportunity with your rifle, I'm guessing.
Yes.
So if you click your rifle, 10 meters is within point blank range. So your overall mod is going to be a negative 1. Plus 6, plus 1. So roll your rifle skill.
Got it.
Rifle skill with negative 1.
Nice.
That's 15. That's 4 level success. So I'm gonna roll your damage just to kind of explain how it works here.
Sure.
So I hit roll damage. The first thing that's gonna pop up is something that says level of success damage modifier. And since you have 4 levels of success, that's gonna be 1 for you. Modifier to damage multiplier, that has to do with your point blank range, and that's going to also be a 1. And then I hit roll, and that hits for 15 damage, which unfortunately doesn't kill this thing, but tell me what it looks like as bullets explode in this thing's chest and it still comes for you. What are you thinking and feeling?
Yeah, Terrence is like, what the fuck? That should have that would drop anybody. He is just, his eyes kind of like go big as he sees this guy still charging him after unloading point blank with his rifle. And so he like takes a step back and just would fire again when he's able to.
You can fire again with another negative 2. You can take multiple actions. So this would be a rifle skill with a negative 3 modifier. So rifles with negative 3.
Cool.
9. Barely hits. Barely hits him. Alright, so now I'll let you roll the damage this time.
What?
So your range is going to be level success is going to be 0, but then the other one, the multiplier one, is going to be 1.
For LOS damage mod, what do
that's
I put going to
be
there?
0. 0.
Got it.
And the other one's going to be 1. Boom. Tell me what it looks like as you blow this thing's head off.
Okay, yeah, so I picture like the recoil like from the second shot just kind of like pulls up a little bit, and so that second part of the burst like goes like clean through his head, brains going like poof, just like right out the back of his head, and he falls down dead. After he sees that he falls, finally he would go to check on his brother.
Brother is completely dead, but he as he turns, he looks at you, and your other buddy's like, leave him go, Jim. Leave him go.
Yeah. So my brother started like doing that weird growl thing.
Yeah. Actually, since he grabs you, give me a strength, simple strength check.
Sure. Oh no.
He's got you. And that's a rule of 1, too. It's not going to matter. So that's negative 4. So that's actually a 1. He has hold of you. What are you going to do?
He's growling at me. He's got a hold on me.
He's got a hold of you, and he's going to try to eat your eyes out.
Yeah. So when you say he has a hold of me, he's like, is he holding my leg or is he holding my body? What part is
he holding?
He grabbed
you around your collar and by your Kevlar vest and is trying to eat your face.
He's your brother.
Okay. Presumably, I still have the gun in my hands. So like, if it, I would pull the trigger just reactively. I think
yeah,
is what
it's
he would
a
do.
Rifle though. It's you can try to smack him with the butt of it. I'll give you that. So just do another strength roll.
Sure. Simple or complicated?
Simple. That's enough to at least knock him off of you. He looks at you again, and he's heading towards you, but one of those other seals just blows his head off. And your brother's blood just splatters all over your face.
Terrence, let him be, like I said.
You need to go below deck. And again, you're starting to hear more screaming from, like, on the deck and from below decks everywhere.
Yeah, Terrence is like, all right, look, come with me. We need to stick together. And then he just runs towards the bottom, or runs towards the temporary ICU.
So we're back down in the ICU.
Yeah, Jessica had been, first she was going to head to try to help that medical tech, but he seems like, I think he got killed, right? Like, or is he still bleeding?
Oh yeah, they're all being eaten
She stops and just looks for a way out.
There is a door opposite. There is a door opposite to the the med bay. All the infected now kind of look at you and Ellis.
Okay, so everyone else in the room besides the doctor and Ellis are already turned and like coming at us.
Yes, they're about to.
Yikes. And we have to go through them to get to the exit.
No, there's an exit on, like down here.
Okay. Dr. Perry looks at Ellis and says, "This is out of our control now. We need to get out."
Yeah, we should probably go.
If there's a scalpel nearby or at hand, like, she's just gonna grab something.
Yeah, Petty Officer Ellis would grab his wrench, just ready to smack these things, but there's too many of them now. He's just gonna make a run for it. Yeah, I imagine there's a roll to do for that.
Nope. Yep. You guys are gonna need a run roll, mm-hmm. Both of you. Run!
Run! Exclamation point.
What's that on the skill menu? Yeah. Okay.
The very top of your skill menu, yeah.
12 and 11, I'm just going to roll for one of them.
Uh-oh.
It's the med tech, the big strong one.
Hmm.
Wow.
So the other three run out this door because they just hear, like, apparently it's a buffet. Upstairs.
Oh no.
They run up that way towards Terrence. While the medical tech just is uncannily fast, puts himself between Hank, Jessica, and the door. In from the door bursts Dr. Milner and the captain. And he turns towards you, Jim Lorenz. And so I want all you guys to roll initiative, or random who goes first.
Okay, so how do we do that now? It's just a D10?
Nope, it's on your menu.
Nope, it's
let me double check that.
Skill attribute menu, it's on the
very
top.
There it is.
That's everybody.
Yep.
Dr. Milner. Dr. Milner's closest to Jim Lorenz. He sees what's going on. Oh, he's going to do a douchey move. He's going to try to push the captain.
Oh no!
Into the zombie and like bolt through the door.
Scumbag doctor.
Yeah, you know what though? That's like in every zombie movie. There's like the scientist who does the scummy thing at the end or whatever.
I want so there to be an actual macro for douchey move.
That's not very good. So simple strength check opposed. So Captain Jim.
Alrighty. With lock hands.
What's it look like? What's it look like as they're locked in?
As Dr. Milner attempts to run, he goes to shove the captain, but his decades of experience, he sees it in his periphery and turns and grabs him. They kind of almost do like a locked arm-to-arm wrestler move as they both shove back and forth.
Get off of me!
What have you done to my ship, you son of a bitch? And he kind of shoves him back and forth. And
he's kind of locked with him. What does Jessica Perry do?
I think she tries to get behind this this table, which looks like it has wheels, and just shove it into the medical tech.
Oh, nice. Very good. Strength with a plus two.
That's clever.
No. So you push this thing, but so these gurneys, I don't know if you've ever used one. They have like a foot pedal at the bottom of it. You can see it in this picture. This one's locked. So when that red's down, that means it's locked in position.
Yeah.
And this is probably what would have happened because,
for safety.
I mean, you're not going to think to unlock it before you push it. You push against this thing, it's just locked. It will not move.
Yeah, she curses and starts to fumble with her foot to unlock it.
Captain Lorenz.
Captain Lorenz, enraged by what this doctor is trying to do, will attempt to maneuver him in between the ravenous medical tech and himself.
All right.
What would that be?
You could do brawling. You could do. You do another strength if you want. Depends.
Let's see. I'm gonna try a brawling.
Okay.
The captain here, furious, is. For what has been unleashed upon his ship, kind of does his best to swing him to the left, and then with one hand tries to punch him and kind of send him towards the monster, trying to get the doctor and himself.
Oh, nice.
Very nice.
Nice.
So tell me what it looks like as you throw him to the tech falls on him.
As,
I need sound effects too.
Yeah, as Dr. Milner is trying to move him, he's inferior, be it from his civilian life to his radiation poisoning to his time, you know, spent as a doctor. But he brings back his right hand and punches him square underneath the nose, sending him sprawling backwards. And the medical tech kind of jumps on him, and Dr. Milner is like, as he starts getting overwhelmed, he's like, no!
Milner now gets the red tent.
Captain waves to Hank and Jessica. He goes, let's go now. Motions for the bulkhead door.
Yeah, Jessica doesn't have to be told twice.
You guys bust out to the hallway. And just as you bust out to the hallway, kind of running down the gantry, is Lieutenant Jim and a couple SEALs. I'll let you guys roleplay that, and we're going to take a 5-minute bio break. That's cool.
The captain, seeing the LT come down the hallway, jerks a thumb behind him. Kill anything that comes out of that door, soldier. And gets behind the SEALs.
I don't know what's going on, but anyone who came off of that ship seems to be going absolutely crazy.
What the hell happened in there? Why is that? Why are they covered in blood and attacking us?
I don't know, but I can't. It's not safe to get close enough to find out. I'm afraid that. I'm afraid they're going to need to get put down. You need to get weapons.
Yeah. Lieutenant Jim, he makes his way off to the bulkhead, like, kind of like, yes, sir, we lost a seal, and there are sailors who are infected up top, sir. What's going on down here? We heard there was an alarm.
My entire medical team's been killed. We need to get weapons.
Shit.
You can hear them pounding on the door now. And you see Milner's face gets pressed up against the glass of the door, and he starts banging his head against it. Like a rabid monkey.
We need to get to the bridge now.
Yeah, I feel like while y'all are talking, there's like a cinematic effect where Ellis is just, all he hears is like, woo, 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 woo. He just has like this headache, and he worries that there's, it's like, the whole world's gone crazy. He doesn't know what's going on. He's just kind of losing it. He doesn't believe what's happening.
The captain orders both the LT and one of his SEALs, hand me your sidearm.
Yeah, he'll give I think at this point, Terrence will tell the SEALs to give up their sidearms to one to Ellis, one to Perry, and one to Lorenz. And then they can, that way at least everybody's armed.
The bridge now. And he just kind of takes off at a sprint to get there.
Yeah, Terrence, after looking at it, he asks one SEAL to guard their rear, and he runs up front with Lorenz, and one is in the middle so that they're all dispersed.
And as you're running, Terrence just exerting himself, he's sure it's the exertion. His mouth just feels totally dry. He just feels so hot and flushed, like he's coming down with a fever. But it's probably just all the stress. And we'll take a 5-10 minute break, and then we'll come back.
No.
Will we?
Out of character. This is like my least favorite moment of every zombie movie. when everybody's like, "Oh man, they're so angry, they're hitting everybody. What the hell's going on?"
What could it be?
I'm like, "It's zombies! It's fucking zombies!"
Well, in this universe, maybe. The zombie mythos isn't quite so popular, you know?
Oh, yeah. No. I get it.
Yes.
I'm just saying, like...
Why do you not, like, say zombie?
Oh, trust me. Yeah, it's, like, out of character. I'm like, I'm about to lock us all securely in the bridge with two people that have cotton mouth and have a fever.
I don't have cotton mouth.
I think Ellis and I both have,
I didn't know that you failed yours, too. Okay.
Oh, maybe that's what he was asking us to roll earlier.
Oh, I'm sure it was.
Shoot. I didn't even think of that. Lame.
Oh, boy. I'm going to go...
Is there a self-destruct on carriers?
No. But there is something that I'm going to do, which no one will like, but we'll save that for a little bit while I go get some water.
And four. Likewise. Yeah, earlier when I was accidentally making a bunch of noise, I think I role-played that Terrence was like doing everything he could to stay busy and not feel nervous. And that was a little bit of bleed through, because that's exactly why I was making a bunch of noise over here, cleaning my desk and listening, because I was so gosh darn nervous.
I'm back.
cool with it.
I'm like loving this.
Say what?
I said I'm loving this.
Yeah, me too.
I feel like any horror movie, it's always like, why would you go in there and investigate the sound? But like, for me in real life, like, that's what I would do because I don't believe in zombies and monsters. Like.
Yeah.
Like, the only way to roleplay it is to be the stupid one who investigates the sound, because
yeah,
there's no such thing as zombies.
Yeah, 100%.
I've been designated by my wife as the noise checker in the middle of the night, so I mean, I'm like, what's that noise? I guess I have to go check. I don't go, there's a noise down there. Let me go ahead and get out my assault rifle real quick and, you know,
right.
Get
like my jungle boots out.
Yeah. Who besides me has piloting?
That's our secret getaway that you've discovered.
Apparently, I can fly single fixed wing
interesting
things.
I can swim. I don't know if I can swim this for a long time.
Can you speak dolphin?
Whale.
Yeah, that's what you need.
Little Aquaman.
I have piloting helicopter.
Ooh, that's even better.
So now it's turning into 28 weeks later.
Yes, please, by all means, take off in the helicopter in the middle of a tropical storm or whatever we're in the Pacific.
It feels like the safer bet.
All right, guys, I'll go get help.
BRB.
Are there, like, life raft type vehicles? I mean, little boats that'll go off the ship. Probably.
Oh, yeah. They would be required to have, X amount of lifeboats for, a crew of 6,000.
You're all going down with the ship.
I just wonder why it's not making your damage correct. It's fucking weird. Check this macro, 6 ways from Sunday.
Oh, earlier, by the way, I was totally digging the lore about the under the ocean facility, and I was just like, oh my gosh! Just nerding out over here.
We have the thing, and we have 28 weeks later mashed together right now. And, what was that movie? Deep Star 6, not exactly the same, but we have elements of all three.
All right, give me a second. Get your sidearm set up. Must be something with set of tribute. Bear with me here.
No worries, taking time.
So just thinking aloud, but if this, do we know how long ago they escaped from the facility?
I probably could have asked the doctor, but he was a dick,
yeah.
So we're not going to get an answer
from him. It's like, let's wait until they all board your ship, and then I'm going to tell you.
Yeah, right.
There must be a limit on what chat set attribute can do. That's fine. Let's plug it into your sheets. So you guys will have to roll your pistols from your sheets. That's the only fail for tonight, so that's fine. Alright, so I'm going to say pistol, one shot. I don't know what your skill rating is. We'll just do it manually when it comes to it. It's fine. Do you guys have a, nine millimeter pistols? And you guys are like what? Moving down the hallway. Where are you heading?
We're heading towards the bridge.
Heading towards the bridge. Okay, got it. Got it.
Can I have a small point of order?
Small point of order. Go ahead.
I do want to point out I'm still wearing that mop gear.
Got it.
10-4. Ready to roll.
Turn on chaos.
Somehow Sirenscape not working is even more ominous. Oh, there we go.
just had to reset everything.
There we go. That's the general level of anxiety I was looking for.
All right, give me some role play as you kind of like run down these hallways as fast as you can. You run past multiple kind of side exits and entrances, and as you look down, you just see people just getting mauled, and there's no dead people because they get eaten, and they just wake straight up and just go on the search for more food. So I'll let you kind of just kind of roleplay that as you guys are running down all the hallways.
Yeah, Jim is like, I can see him huffing and puffing and you know, maybe wanting to go and help whoever he sees on the ground. Like you said earlier, he's getting a little bit hot, so maybe he like, for just like a brief moment, brings his wrist up to his head. But he, he's like, all right, gotta get to the bridge, and he is like checking corners as they're going through, to you know, reminding all the SEALs to do that. Just, all right, we have to do this by the book. Be safe, we gotta go fast, but be safe.
The doctor is looking at the sidearm that she's been given, finding the safety, you know, all a bit awkwardly, and turning it off. And running down the hall, she's keeping herself in the middle of all these military men, looking nervously, fearfully all around them.
You know, the captain, as he runs, makes mental notes of how quickly individuals get up after being attacked. What type of people are being attacked? If they're random people, or if they're Marines, or someone that is supposed to be out and about during general quarters, and trying his best to formulate a plan to regain control of the ship.
Noting how fast this is spread. Oh, I'm sorry. You do your say your piece.
Sure. I feel like Ellis is kind of like Captain, that he's trying to think about this thing like logically, but it's just so upsetting for him to see these young guys just go insane and start killing each other. I think what he's doing is well, he's moving way faster than he has in a long time, because this is like sincerely the most terrifying thing he's ever seen. So he's really moving down the halls now, but he's gripping onto his pipe wrench, and he's just running with all his might to try to get to somewhere safe.
As they're passing so many people, and it becomes obvious that this is something that's spread very quickly to the rest of the crew, the doctor turns to the captain and says, I have never seen anything this contagious. Captain, at this rate, there will not be a single person on the ship that has not been infected. We need to start thinking about getting off the ship.
He grunts, and as he's running, kind of puffs out. Right now, we need to think about the larger picture, not ourselves. We need to get to the bridge, and from there, we will decide what to do.
you guys are sprinting down these corridors, looking back, you see, kind of heading out of one of the barracks, four snarling people, and they just look at you, and they turn their baleful eyes on you, and they start to chase you as fast as they absolutely can. They're closing on you. You're at 20. You're at 15 yards. What do you guys do? More actually start to join them from the wings as they chase you down the hallway.
Is there like a door or a bulkhead up ahead as we're going through these corridors? Sorry.
You do. You see an exit way up ahead. This is like one of the main corridors of the ship. And so it's probably like 100 yards ahead. It's far.
How close are we to the bridge, or are we just the bulkhead?
There's a stairway up to the bridge. That's where the exit is.
To the stairs! As he sees more and more coming out, there's no way the four of them can stop that onslaught with the weaponry they have in hand. It's going to be a foot race to the door and then shutting it behind them and locking it.
Yeah, more just kind of join the throng as they go past like barracks, restrooms, the mess hall, the armory, etc. All right, everybody, make me a run check.
Ugh.
Who's the slowest?
Oh, the old man.
So I'll let you roleplay what it looks like as you guys are almost to the door, and there's a very fast one kind of right up front. And he just leaps, and falls upon Captain Jim, trying to tackle you to the floor. Give me a simple strength. Ooh, he rolled a 17.
Oof.
Oh, he rolled a 17. Shit.
Yep. So he has you pinned down. What are you guys, all the other guys going to do? They're going to be upon you in moments. What are you guys going to do?
Jim tells the SEALs, he just says, fire! Indicating on the zombie, fire! Get the captain in here and lock the door!
So you want them to fire on the horde approaching you, or the one on the captain?
The one on the captain.
Okay, so the other ones are going to catch you if you do that.
So you're saying that there's no possible way we can save the captain?
No, I'm not saying that. You could have them kind of try to hold off the board while you blow the thing's brains out.
Gotcha. All right, so yeah, that's what he'll say. Focus on keeping them at bay! And then he motions to the rest of the party, to Dr. Perry, Ellis, and he says, fire on the one on top of the captain! And all of us can both take a shot.
All right, so this is going to be a point blank. Give yourself actually a +2 on it. And since you're just like blowing his head off from point blank, if you hit any damage at all, you're going to kill it.
Who's rolling now?
Terrence.
You said this is a +2, right?
That's correct. Tell me what it looks like as you save the captain's life.
So yeah, he just like, he like pops this thing, he like just shoots it right in the head, its brains go flying, and then you can like see it, you can smell the all of like the powder, the gunpowder, just like in the air from all of the different gunfire. And he's just yelling, he's like, Ellis, Perry, we need to get the captain in here and lock the door now.
And Captain Jim, let's you role play what looks like is this thing just falls dead upon you, headless. And you have to kind of pry yourself out from underneath the body. The SEALs are doing a good job mowing down many of these things, but no doubt some are going to get through.
as he's struggling on his back on the floor trying to keep this thing away from him, the LT comes up and shoots it in the head and it falls, and he kind of moves to one side to prevent it from falling on directly on top of him, and does his best to scramble up to his feet as quickly as possible. And as he sees the seals holding him off as best as he can, he makes a decision that no captain wants to make, and motions for the LT, the doctor, and Hank to move through the door.
Yeah, Hank will follow orders. He would even try to help the captain up, get him into safety, because he's like the Smithers to the captain's, Mr. Burns.
Yeah.
Is there any, like, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say Dr. Perry continues down the hall, but as the captain gets up and prepares to join them, she kind of takes a moment to look aside at him, doing a quick mental assessment. Did he get bitten? Because she's already starting to get paranoid about that.
Do you have notice?
I do, but I didn't ask.
No.
Okay, just give me a complicated perception then. You, in the heat of the moment, you just can't tell. You can't tell what's going on. Two guys run faster and faster. The Navy SEALs, Lieutenant Terrence, they just hold off these zombies as long as they can. Eventually, some of the SEALs actually get caught, and you see them just getting torn to shreds down the hall. As you guys run as fast as you can, towards that door at the end. You see it open, and there's an officer, there's a naval officer kind of holding open with you. He says, "Captain, hurry, hurry, come on, come on, make it, make it."
Captain waves his hand towards the doctor and Hank and the LT. "Hurry, we need to close this door behind it and secure it. We need to get to the bridge. This is worse than we thought."
Yeah, right. I'm right there. I make certain, Terrence makes certain he's the last one, so he's closing the door and barring it as soon as they make it through.
You guys see, though, as you get closer and closer, the zombies behind you, that officer starts to close the door, starts to slam it. What are you guys going to do?
It's treason, then.
I can't. I'm sorry, Captain.
You hold that door open. I'm gonna see if there's a skill I could yell at him to scare him into keeping that open.
Command.
There's not. If you can do willpower, a simple willpower, and with your charisma, you get a +3.
All right. Hold that door open, soldier.
This is one you. This is one you need to make. This is what you need to make.
So simple. Modifier 3, +3.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Oh, thank the Lord.
So he's, I'm sorry! He's about ready to shut it, and then he goes, hurry! And tell me what it looks like as you guys kind of spill out onto the bridge.
Ellis is trying to push
both. Which thus far is
secure. Terrence is trying to be the last one out, Ellis is trying to push the doctor and the captain through. Concerned about both of their safety.
Captain jumps through the door, making straight for the bridge to start issuing orders, assuming that both the officer and Terrence will get the door closed and locked behind them, secured behind them.
The doctor is looking all around, looking for anyone who might have been injured. Upon not seeing anyone right away, she is going to walk over to the captain and say, "Captain, did you get bitten?"
I don't think so. And he kind of does like a pat down of himself to search real quickly.
She's going to do, you know, walk all around him and just quickly assess if she sees any wounds.
As she's looking him over, the captain kind of starts barking orders into the comms officer. He's like, get fleet command on the horn now. And then he turns to navigation. He goes, heading 180, make for deep water, full speed. And he goes, and somebody get me on the PA.
The comms officer, everybody on the bridge is armed. He just kind of turns to you. I'm sorry, Captain. I regret to inform you. Engines are dead in the water. Comms are down. We had a bit of a rebellion here earlier, sir. You look like some of the instruments have been shot and fried. There are a couple dead bodies, but there don't seem to be. There's like bullet holes in their heads. We're dead in the water. Jeez. With no way to reach home. We gotta make it out of here, Captain. What do we do? What do we do?
Calm yourself. And he kind of shakes him and considers slapping him for a moment, as Leslie Nielsen once famously did in Airplane. Look, if we're dead in the water, we need to get to engineering. We need to get to the drive training, get this operational.
Is that really going to work with a ship full of... We need to get to a lifeboat.
I am the captain of this ship. I am not going to abandon it. Not yet. And you would not last very long in this lifeboat. In these waters. And he kind of points out to the windows of the deck, showing the storm.
Longer than out there. She gestures toward the door.
Terrence is, he is all about making certain that the door is solid. So, I mean, like, after it's barred, he's I picture him, like, at the top of the stairs, just kind of, like, keeping his gun trained on the door and his eyes on it, beads of sweat coming down his face. And he looks at the officers, the two officers that are already on the bridge, and he just says, where have you bitten? Were any of you in contact with the infected?
No, we held them off. As far as we know, the intercom, we've been on it for the last 30 minutes. The mess hall, the armory, the engine room, even your office, Captain, it's all been overwhelmed. As far as we know, this is the last safe place on the ship.
He turns to Hank and he goes, is there any way you can get comms functioning? Anything? I need to get a message out.
Hey, Ellis looks around and he says, it's all fucked. There's nothing we can do. He's just furious at the whole thing. There's nothing else visible. He just starts taking his wrench and smashing things.
Wait. Not to beat a dead horse, but aren't there radios on the lifeboats?
No. What are you doing, Ellis? As the doctor kind of mentions that, what are you doing, Ellison? Calm yourself now. I said, get this working. I don't want to hear a no. I want you to take the panel off here. And he points to, you know, the comm station. Start hot wiring something until you get a signal through. And he kind of like looks at Ellis like, what an odd thing to do, to like start smashing something with a wrench.
He looks at you with a mad look in his eyes. It just says, I'm doing everything I can, just smashing things. He says, is this working, Captain? Does this work, Captain? And just starts smashing things in the control room there.
The captain takes a step away from him and raises his gun. He goes, you will put that wrench down now.
Get him, Hank. Turn.
Is there something... could I... am I still in control of my character?
Yeah. Okay, great. You want to kill everybody now.
I'm now red. I forget that I have not just a wrench, but I also have a sidearm, which I will take out and tell the captain, lower your weapon, captain. You've lost control of the ship.
I don't think you can do that this time. Your intelligence is one.
I am now getting stupider as well. Awesome.
And your strength is plus two. So I will make those changes.
Fun. I appreciate that. I'm now going to attempt to attack my friend, the captain.
And captain, understanding now the speed at which this contagion spreads, makes no hesitation to fire.
And the doctor's also all backing right off and firing.
Let's see who goes first.
And with Terrence hearing all of this, he would fire as well.
How do we roll off for that as initiative, of course?
It's in the tribute menu.
Sure.
So I missed the first time, but thank God not this time. I have fast reaction time. I go first in combat.
Ooh. You do?
Oh, damn.
The old captain assumes a firing position and brings the pistol up and aims down the sights and shoots.
All right, I'm going to put Shields, because he's like 10. And I'll put it in order here.
Yeah, Ellis is no longer even wielding his branch. He throws it down and he's looking at the... it's like he can hear the heartbeat of the captain as he yells at him, staring right at his neck. One of those like ultraviolet, like you can see his blood pumping, infrared, yes. Whatever, what have you.
Yes. All right. So do point blank. Wait, was it pistols? With your guns, pistols, or whatever it's called, handguns. So I believe you get a plus one to hit at point blank range.
Yes, sir. I'll make sure, but I'm sure it is. Yep, plus one.
12. That's two level success. Not enough for other bonuses, but you get because of the range, your damage mod on the multiplier is one, so you can roll damage there.
LOS damage mod one. Okay. And no modifier to damage multiplier.
No. The LOS damage is, you can just close out of it. The LOS damage is zero, and the other one would be one.
Ah. Pew, pew, pew.
25!
Nice!
He has 29, though.
I'm gonna shoot again. Fuck this guy. Alright, so...
So I just knocked down 25 points, is that correct?
Yep.
And the modifier would be minus one.
Well
because
done, sir.
It's two on my second shot, but I have a plus one for being short range, correct?
That'd be correct.
So please. I imagine that first shot went like right through his neck and he just he's still lunging for the captain.
This is the second one.
Is there a third action? Or can I
you
save
can,
that for a
you
defensive?
Can, but... Well, I think that would be probably what you could do as he's lunging to you. Pop off too.
Yeah. I was going to save it for defensive anyway. The second shot doesn't even ring close to true as the first one, and it goes wide as it sails over his left shoulder as it comes. He comes barreling towards the captain, and he readies himself for this now slammering thing that used to be his friend.
Jessica Perry.
All right, she's shooting.
Handguns, 12. That's a hit. So what you can do is just use Jim Lorenz's damage on his off his token. Yep. So you just click on that.
All right.
The range. So the LOS will be zero, and the other one will be one. Should do it.
Don't jinx it like that.
It wouldn't let me roll off of his sheet.
I'll just do it.
Yeah.
Oh, exactly!
Oh, what's it look like?
Yeah, she is her hands kind of shaking, but she's backing up. She sees the captain unload on him, and part of her is just reciting the Hippocratic Oath in her head, but this thing is this thing's not even a person anymore. It's not Hank anymore. That's the last thing she says before she fires, and it barely clips his artery. It looks almost like it's not going to be enough, but as it, you know, the blood pushes against it, it bursts out into a gush, and he falls on the floor.
He does that. He just right leaning toward the feet of the captain, just he's done. Blood pools all around.
I'm gonna give you access to the comms officer, Jeremy Bullock, now.
Great.
You're Jeremy now.
He's like, that's the kind of shit that's going on out there? Okay.
So, Jessica, after killing Hank, hands shaking, she kind of lowers her firearm, and she says, "Nobody touch Hank." And she backs away from the blood pooling on the floor.
If the gun is not covered in blood, he's going to take the gun from Hank and eject the magazine and put it into his pocket.
Yeah, you do that.
The captain continuing asking, "Officer Bullock, try and get comms up." And he kind of starts thinking over his head a way to get to either engines or to get the ship operational. And then he looks over the doctor. "Doctor, best estimate on how quickly this spreads before the entire crew is compromised?"
"Captain, I think we're the only ones left."
"Yes."
She looks at him like, kind of like, "I think that you're..."
"I guess I should stop the gunfire and stuff."
"You're, like, concerned, like, he's kind of, is he in denial?" That's kind of like what she thinks.
He's not thinking it's spread that fast.
She says, "Look out."
You can hear them just like pounding on
Look
the door
out.
Again, right?
There's no one else out there. It's just the infected.
Is there, besides the stairway we came up, is there any other egress route out of the bridge?
Let me whisper to
It's a tough, I've never been on an aircraft carrier, so I can't tell you, but I would assume when they're on the bridge, the command deck, you know, all the radar towers and whatnot above it.
This music makes me feel like I'm in an action video game.
You are.
Yeah. While Bo's doing that, Terrence, just thinking with whatever, he's looking around for loose, just anything loose, and he's like, "We need to begin piling things up in the stairwell. Anything we can to buy us some time. The bulkhead should hold. It can't be that easy to break through. But it's always good to have a plan B." So whatever's not nailed down, chairs, whatever, he'll begin throwing it into the stairwell right behind the bulkhead, because it seems like they know we're here.
Yeah, apologies. I didn't realize I was muted. Captain, the comms officer pipes up. He says, there is a back hallway down here from the bridge to the main deck. There's a helicopter there we might be able to get to.
Do any of us know how to fly a helicopter?
I can.
Right?
I knew it. Very well. And he kind of organizes, all right, Lieutenant, organize the remaining people here on the bridge. We're going to move out in 5 minutes. Everybody be ready. Don't let them bite you. Don't let any of their blood get on you. Silence is key.
Yeah, so Jim, where Terrence begins like checking weapons, making certain that everybody's topped off on ammunition, whatever's in their magazine. Telling to, like, he'll take point, stay behind me. I'll make, you know, want to make certain that we're all safe. And he just begins to kind of like organize everybody by the door.
Dr. Perry is staring at Hank's body, half in shock, but it suddenly occurs to her, I don't think Hank was ever bitten. She goes through her memory trying to think, but he still got infected. He might have just been exposed to the blood at some point. Maybe when we were on the submersible. That would make sense because his change was so much slower. Look, we all need to be very, very aware and willing to assess ourselves and how we're feeling. Because I think if Hank had known what was happening to him, he wouldn't have put us all in danger. Is everyone here feeling all right? And she kind of looks around at everyone in the room.
The captain as well, looking for any signs of lying as she lays out that you might get infected even not being bitten.
Comms officer just puts his hands up like, hey, I'm clean. Don't look at me.
Lieutenant?
He kind of like wipes his brow and he looks at her and he says, I think I'm feeling a little bit hot, but we've been running a lot, so I think that's all it is just from the running.
She nods, but she's gonna take a minute to put a stethoscope on him, you know, look into his eyes under a light, and see if he seems okay. Or if there's anything obvious.
You don't have a thermometer, but he feels hot to the touch for sure. He's acting fine, but his heart rate's 120. And he has these petechial hemorrhaging in his eyes.
Yeah.
So like little kind of blood spots.
She backs away from him. I can't say for certain. She kind of looks over at the captain. Captain, can you come over here for a minute? I want you to see what I'm seeing.
Captain comes over kind of cautiously after how quickly Hank went berserk and, you know, waits for the doc to explain what she sees.
She says there's petechial hemorrhaging in his eyes. It's broken capillaries. That doesn't usually happen from normal amounts of exertion, not even from running. Extreme vomiting, maybe.
Besides the LT, doc, captain, officer Bullock, and the officer, who else? How many other people are in here?
Oh, just a couple. There's the cowardly naval officer, maybe a few other seamen, but. Like, there's some dead bodies that have bullets in their heads and stuff.
The doctor's gonna go around kind of looking at everybody's eyes.
The naval officer is in the same shape as Jim Terrence.
She bites her lip. If there's any other people in there, she'll look at them too.
And they're all fine. Okay.
She comes back. Yeah, no, I think we're good. But then she's gonna walk over to the captain and say, I think Jim and that naval officer, they're both showing that hemorrhaging in the eyes. It's not certain, but it's certainly unusual.
Captain lets out a big sigh. He knows what he has to do, but he's not gonna say it out loud. I know it's a movie cliche, Bo, but how easy would it be to get to some of the ordnance magazines and rig some sort of explosion to blow up the ship?
It'd be really hard. It's a place overrun. Yeah, extremely hard.
Slightly It'd better be a chance death. Of reaching the helicopter.
Yeah.
What about a life raft?
Yeah, maybe. Or it could be filled with the infected.
So
who knows? You're cloistered up in this bridge, right? Yeah. As you look down, like on the deck, you can't see like where the helicopter is, but it's just kind of swarming with infected, just running around looking for something.
All right. So the two we know that are probably infected are the naval officer and Terrence. Is the
Terrence? What do you have to say for yourself?
She's not being real obvious about it. She's just kind of having this quiet discussion with the captain.
Yeah.
Can you let me see if you have notice. Let me see if you have notice.
I do have notice. Yep. I checked.
Hey, give me that. Give me that at a negative one. Just to see if and you can if you want to oppose it, Jessica, okay. you can use intelligence. Yeah, I'd be fine with that.
No, but he beat me. He hears some of it.
Oh.
So, it's not maybe not that, but you're just not
acting right,
right?
Yeah, she keeps looking at him out of the corner of her eye.
Yeah. So I've been, unfortunately, privy to a lot of, like, people here, like, the doctor's, like, looks at the images and they haven't told the patient yet, and there's a look on their face. That's what happens. What do you think, Jim?
Jim,
and Officer Bullock, you've been thrust into this situation. What the fuck?
Yeah, Bullock is not calling any shots. He's waiting for the captain to make decisions.
So I think overhearing that, he just like mutters to himself, just fuck. And he takes his, like, maybe I like picture his assault rifle like hanging by a sling, and he like pulls it off of him and puts it maybe like on a counter, and he says, we don't have much time. Do we have anything that we can use to write? And you see him like maybe like walking, like washing like the perspiration off of his head.
Captain Jim picks up the AR and goes, you're a SEAL. You know. Unfortunately, some people don't have nerves of steel like you. And he turns to Naval Officer 2 with the AR and blows him away.
Tell me what it looks like in gruesome detail, please.
Blows both of us away, or just the Naval Officer?
Just the Naval Officer. Because not only is the captain still furious he tried to close the door on him, he also shows the signs of turning. And being a SOCOM M16 almost assuredly has full auto. So he turns it to full auto and just unloads from starting at the hip and then just letting the recoil take it up the right side and just blows through his chest. He was infected. He had to die.
Yeah, Jim looks at that Yeah, Terrence looks at that, and he looks down, and he nods, and he's like, I know.
You know you can't fly that helicopter. We'll crash into the water.
We need to do one thing, or you need to do one thing. We can use these windows to send a message. We need to write something on it, even if it's my own blood. Don't come on board. It infected something. So that this stays here. It might be the only chance we have at sending out something.
This is an aircraft carrier. The U.S. Navy will not just leave it alone. We have to find some way to keep people off. A simple message won't work. And the captain kind of starts racking his brain over USSS, or naval procedure on something that could try and keep people away.
So, does Jim or does Terrence have like a knife on him or something?
Yeah, I think he probably would. I mean, he like got geared up. He had like one of those Rambo montages before him and his boys left. Him and his boys are all dead. He can get his money back, I guess, but they're all dead.
So, Terrence, if there's like no Sharpie or anything on the bridge.
There are those wax pencils that you see like in Red October on the charts. They write the charts.
Okay. Yeah. I was thinking like dry erase markers or something else.
Yeah, yeah.
He looks at the captain and he just says, listen, I know you want something bigger. I know you want to make it definitively clear. But if all we can do is just write something on this window to let them know. And then he just asks, he asks somebody for the handgun. Says, I'll do it myself.
No, I have one last mission for you, LT. And he looks over to Bullock and he goes, right on the windows.
Infected quarantine.
Infected. Right, infected. And then he goes over to Jim and kind of quietly whispers, he goes, I have one last mission for you. You know that it's only a matter of time. You need to go to the helicopter and you need to start it up and draw these things away so that the doctor and I, whoever else is not sick, get on a lifeboat and try and warn people. And Jim knows he's sending him on a suicide mission to provide an opportunity for us to flee.
And Terrence knows he's being sent on a suicide mission, but he nods because he knows. He just knows. So he just slowly nods.
Then as soon as Bullock gets done writing infected on the windows, they go to the alternate stairwell to make their way to the flight deck.
Here we go. So there's a back hallway kind of sealed off by two doors. And there's this kind of red light that glow, right? And that alarm is still going on. Just to make matters worse. And eventually, you kind of creak and you look out towards where the helicopter is. And you see the deck, the area around the lifeboats just has several infected just dashing back and forth. But they look different. Their heads are just malformed.
Oh, yikes.
And they're just sniffing there. But you also see, as you kind of crack open the door, is you see like on the other side of the deck, as if they're trying to make their way to that helicopter, crouched behind a crate, you see two men with kind of combat helmets and flak jackets on, kind of crouched in the rain, kind of waiting for some sort of opportunity. But just like you, they just seem like fucking scared shitless. What are you guys doing?
Stick to the plan.
Captain gives a salute as he's behind cover to the LT and goes, "Your sacrifice will allow us to stop this here so it doesn't spread to the rest of the world."
Terrence slowly nods, and at that, she like takes a big deep breath, maybe like opens up like a pouch, opens up like a wallet, sees like picture, maybe he has like a wife, takes like one last look at her, closes it, and then he just runs as fast as he can and makes the biggest, loudest noise. And just like, because I'm trying to distract them to get away, right? That was the plan? Just...
Yep.
Okay, yeah, I just wanted Bullock to make certain I understood the plan.
If possible, Bullock would maybe light up like a signal flare and toss it in the direction of the chopper.
Yeah, I don't know what would I have something like that?
Yeah, I think on the bridge you definitely would have like a flare gun or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Okay. So he's looking out for a bridge, like he runs, and he's looking out for a flare gun, and presumably like when he sees one, he grabs it and he sees those security officers, and he fires it in their direction.
Nice.
So so Jim Terrence, star of the show. All right, make me a run check, first of all. Make me a run check. 9? Not really great. So, Horizons, these guys are going to have to make, let's just do intelligence. He failed. He failed. They think you're an infected, right?
Okay.
They think you're infected. Let's see what the infected actually do. Fail. Fail.
Oh my gosh.
Well, they have intelligence of 1.
Yeah, they're not too bright. Fair enough. I mean, look at them.
Well, and I don't even know what a fail for them means in this context.
I think these ones have an intelligence of -2, actually.
Maybe they're just tricked.
Yeah, they're tricked. They're tricked by you. So what happens, Jim Terrence, is you can tell me how your death looks. I'm not going to roll for it. But simultaneously, the security guards think you're an effect coming through them, right? That it doesn't register that the flare goes off, but they just lay into you with their automatic weapons.
So yeah, I think it's almost like a platoon, right? So he's like running and like just like a shot like comes out. I picture like the rain is like beating him, like that first shot like hits him and kind of like in some fleshy area, starts bleeding, and he's like coughing up blood. He like wipes it as best as he can. He sees that the infected are running after him, are running, and he just like fires that, like he's like getting shot. Another one hits him, like lands on the ground, and like he like weakly brings up this like flare gun and fires it off at the security guards, and just like takes one last breath and collapses onto the ground dead.
And it draws all 3 of these guys in, and they just fall upon your body, just ripping it to shreds. As that happens, the 2 security guards just dash to the helicopter. So they kind of see their window too in all this, right? So what does Bullock, Perry, and Lorenz do?
Now that it's a little bit clear towards the lifeboats, is that correct?
Yep.
Yep, I'm beating feet as quickly as possible while Terrence is being killed, and If the two soldiers are getting into the helicopter, the startup of that is definitely going to draw more attention. So he's going
to... Yeah, we're sticking to the plan.
Yeah. The plan is currently working, so we're going to stick with it.
You guys sprint away. As you do that, you hear that the helicopter start to spin up. What does it look like, Jessica Perry, as you run across the deck? It's almost dawn, but it's still dark. It's darkness just before the dawn. As you run across this towards where the lifeboats are, to release the lifeboats into the storm and into the water.
She takes off right after the captain. And as she's running across the deck, she takes a couple of glances over her shoulder, winces as Lieutenant Terrence is taken down in a hail of gunfire, then clenches her jaw, turns around as the infected rush toward the helicopter, and she says a prayer, not a religious woman, but right now it seems like the only thing even a woman of science can do, and just runs as fast as she can toward those lifeboats.
Terrence, I want to let you role play just what it's like to become feral immediately. Stand up, and you are just so enraged at all these guys. You just want to tear all the throats out, and you and your other infected friends turn on them and start to chase them.
Hmm. Start to chase who?
Your friends. You are our turn now.
Gotcha. So he's just like...
Give me your best feral moment.
Yeah, so you see his, like, his eyes go wide, and maybe, like, his pupils, like, go to, like, pinpricks, is, like, his eyes go full bloodshot. And he's just like... And he just, like, stands up and just starts running off towards his friends at full speed.
Jeremy Bullock, tell me what it looks like as you guys are running as fast as you can towards where the boats are.
I feel like the only way, it's hard to see on the map here, so we're running toward the map as these guys are chasing behind us.
Yeah, I mean, this is just art, so, right?
Sure, no, it's fine. I'm trying to get a sense of what I would be doing. I want to do one of those things where I'm, like, shooting and running backwards, but I'd rather just be running at full speed. A couple
cinematically
of
you can do that, yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple of shots to be fired behind my back, but I'm really concentrating on moving as quickly as possible. This is terrifying.
Okay, boys and girl, run.
Oh dear. Yeah, okay, shall I roll off of Ellis's stats, perhaps?
You can run off of Bullock's if you want.
I don't have access to his token, unfortunately.
You should have access to Bullock.
Oh, is it in there?
I changed it.
I still can't click on.
Try now.
Oh, there he is. Well, I see him, but I don't have access to the token.
That's really
weird.
Sorry,
let me just slow this down.
I'll just roll for you, I guess.
Thanks.
You did so well last time.
Oh,
oh no!
No!
Gets a red shirt.
All right, slip 13.
He was
Jim 12. Jim Terrence, you're kind of lined up to who you would catch if you catch him. You guys get a -2 on your run. Because they got a head start.
Sure.
So Terrence. So 7. Do you catch anybody? You don't catch Perry, that's for sure.
Yeah, I rolled a 9.
Yep. Infected 11. He's going to run.
Or 7, yeah, my bad.
14,
oh, no.
-2, that's a 12. What did Lorenz get?
12.
Lorenz got 12. A 12.
Does meat beat in the system? I don't know.
I think he just maintained.
I don't know. At that
point. Yeah, he didn't close.
The captain's gonna be like the only survivor.
He is right on you. You can feel. You can feel the blood and the just blood curdling lust right on your neck. And infected 10 is going towards Jeremy Bullock. And that's a 9.
That'll catch up to me.
He totally gets him?
Yeah, well, right, I rolled a 5.
So what does it look like as you get killed for the second time in your introductory game?
Golly, I feel like after having seen the officer get the naval officer 2 get shot, and I think I know what's happening right now. As these guys immediately start ripping into my entrails, but I will turn the gun on myself and shoot myself in the head. So I hopefully don't turn.
Just very cinematic.
Sad acceptance of what's going to happen.
Oh, like, God. Last one's going to roll D3. A D2 now. See who he goes after. 1, Jessica Perry.
Jeez.
That's 11.
That's a miss.
You get away? Okay, here's the decision of the game. Jessica Perry, what do you do as this guy pretty much has Lorenz? Not know what's going to happen. Do you help? Do you get into the lifeboat?
No,
what do you do?
She's running to the lifeboat. She is terrified, just utterly terrified. And she's also terrified for whoever runs into this boat. And so whether it's, I think it's some combination of self-preservation, terror, and fear of what's going to happen if someone does not make it off the ship, that drives her forward. No guilt, none whatsoever. She's just completely determined to get to that boat and to take off no matter what. In her heart of hearts, she thinks the captain would probably do the same.
I'm just, for dramatic reason, he catches you. Jim. He catches you, Captain Jim.
Jim, seeing Dr. Jessica pull away, his old bones don't work quite as they used to. And as the creatures catch him, he's going to start shooting them and directing their attention to him to allow at least one person to escape and spread the word of what is happening here. And he's just going to level his assault rifle and just full auto spray everyone, knowing that it's a defiant last stand, but it's one to buy time for the doctor.
Doctor, you get the last pose out as you hit the life raft and just release it down to the water. It's like a 10 meter drop, probably longer. And you can just tell me what that looks like when I move my rein here.
She practically leaps into the life raft, and everyone on the ship has had to go through some sort of training on how to use them. And in this moment, her eidetic memory serves her well. She remembers how to do it and releases it and plummets toward the water. Hitting it feels almost like hitting concrete. They're so high up, but the life raft holds. She bites her tongue a little at the impact, tastes blood. The waves toss the raft, and she looks around for a means to propel it away from the ship. She realizes, though, that her efforts probably are pretty meaningless in this kind of a storm. So instead, she turns her sights toward the ship, trying to catch some last glimpse of perhaps the captain. Maybe he made it to a life raft. But as the waves carry her farther away from the ship, she realizes that she's the only one. She hears that last bit of automatic fire above the sounds of the storm, and silently thanks the captain for enabling her escape. And as she sails, floats farther and farther away from the ship, she starts to look out for lights on the water.
You see the helicopter rise into the air, Dr. Perry? And you know what must have happened inside that cockpit, because it doesn't get half a mile away, and you see it plunge to the ocean. Just explode. I lied. I'll let Captain Lorenz, Bullock, and Terrence have the last roleplay as their infected characters look over the edge of the carrier, looking down at Perry. Do they just like jump into the ocean after her? They're not going to catch her. But like, what would they do?
The captain, now a feral beast instead of a distinguished officer of the United States Navy, kind of like gets to the edge of the deck and snarling. And then just like takes a step off the edge and then just like hits the water and then sinks like a sack of fucking shit to the bottom as he's... doesn't know A, how to swim, and B, is overloaded with the gear he is wearing. And just reaching up towards the surface, snarling underwater as he slowly sinks to the bottom.
Jeremy Bullock, the only bit blades and blasters recruits, get killed twice in the first game.
It's an honor. Bullock attempted to blow his own brains out, but he still comes to.
Oh, he did. Oh, like, yeah, yeah.
No, it's fine. I imagine it just failed, you know? So he's blown his jaw, his bottom jaw off, and so he's got one of those things where his tongue is just hanging from the top of his head. And he's just, he can't even really, like, eat, but he's just, just looking around and attempts the same. He's going to try to jump after her because he's... Well, he's even dumb for a zombie now that he blew half of his brain out, so... Yeah, he's just gonna jump in there and his disgusting face will sink into the water.
Lieutenant Terrence.
So, yeah, I think Terrence does the same thing. He, like, jumps into the water and, maybe, like, Dr. Perry sees him, and he's actually, like, kind of keeping afloat a little bit, and he's just, like, thrashing like a wild animal in the water. And then, finally, like, it seems like the waves are succumbing with the storm and everything, and there's, like, this quiet moment. Maybe she takes a sigh of breath before he breaches the water one last time, like a zombie movie. And then sinks down to the depths below.
And the camera moves up from the ocean higher and higher as the sun rises over the eastern horizon, outlining a very small boat alone on the ocean, adrift. And we'll end it there.
That's fantastic.
Awesome. Yeah. Pretty unlikely that any of us would make it.
The woman, the doctor, survives. The doctor.
Well, I have the survival
advantage. I thought you'd be the first to die.
Chivalry's on my side.
Misogyny wins again.
So the first thing I saw after you flipped it to this new page, Bo, was Sergeant Hank Ellis.